Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We have no apologies this morning, and our first item of business is an evidence session on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. And I refer members to papers 1 to 3. So I would like to welcome to the meeting Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs. And we will also be joined by a number of officials at various points during the meeting. So I intend to allow up to 2.5 hours for this session. We will stop for a comfort break and I'll suspend as we move between parts of the bill so that officials can change over. Can I remind members to keep any questions or supplementaries they have specific to which part of the bill we are looking at in turn. So can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks?
Good morning, Convener. The Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill places victims and witnesses at the heart of the system. It is informed by the experience of victims and their families and organisations who support them, by independent research, cross-sector groups and individuals with academic, legal and practical expertise. The committee is well aware of the significant and long-standing concerns over the not proven verdict. You have heard evidence that it is not defined or well understood. It can result in confusion and trauma for victims and their families, and it can lead to stigma for the accused. It is vital that we improve the fairness, clarity and transparency of decision-making in the criminal justice system and in criminal cases. The bill would abolish the not proven verdict and retain the widely understood verdicts of guilty and not guilty. Reforms to our criminal justice system must command confidence in its integrity and protect the balance and fairness. Therefore, the bill proposes to make changes to the jury size from 15 to 12 and the majority required for conviction from a simple majority to two-thirds. This is a proportionate way to achieve this balance. Convener, violence against women and girls is a worldwide endemic problem. Lady Dorian has been clear that we need to make seismic, structural, statutory changes to how our system responds to sexual violence. Piecemeal change is not enough to achieve the cultural shift needed to improve the experiences of victims and to give them meaningful access to justice. The bill proposes an automatic lifelong right of anonymity for victims of sexual and certain other offences to ensure privacy and dignity during their lifetime. This may help to increase confidence in reporting offending behaviour, and placing this right in statute is particularly important in today's social media age. The bill also proposes to strengthen the rights of complainers through automatic, publicly funded, independent legal representation when requests are made to lead evidence about their sexual history or character. This substantial reform will ensure that complainers have a right to access their own legal representative who will assist them in ensuring that their voices are heard in what is a deeply intrusive aspect of sexual offence cases. The bill would create a new sexual offences court with national jurisdiction to hear solemn level sexual offending. The court will embed specialist approaches to the way these cases are managed and complainers are treated. It will drive reform of practice, process and culture. Complainers' experiences will be improved through greater use of pre-recorded evidence, better judicial case management and mandatory trauma-informed training for all involved in the work of the court, including the lawyers. Finally, the bill would enable a time-limited pilot of single-judge rape trials. I am aware that there are mixed views on this proposal, which again arose from Lady Dorian's review. And I agree with Lady Dorian that we should explore, in a practical way, the role of juries in delivering justice for victims of rape. Piloting single-judge rape trials for a time-limited period will provide much-needed evidence and let us have a properly informed debate on how our system deals with these most difficult and challenging cases. Convener, you have heard compelling evidence from multiple sources that our Scottish justice system is not working for victims of sexual offences. None of us should be comfortable with that, and as the Lord Advocate observed, it is simply not good enough. As parliamentarians, it's our role to address the issues identified. This is our watch, it is our responsibility. If we don't act, we will pass the problem to our successors and lose the opportunity to bring about real change for victims going through the system now and in the future. No part of the system should be beyond scrutiny. The Bill puts forward proposed reforms, and I repeat my remarks in Chamber last May during a debate about trauma-informed justice. If not this, what? If not now, when? And it is time to move forward in the debate, and I hope we can do so together. So thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So I'm going to start off this first session with questions on part four of the bill, namely the abolition of not proven and changes to jury majorities. So if I can start with an opening question, Cabinet Secretary. As you say, we've heard a range of views on what is being proposed around the not proven verdict and jury majorities. So is the Scottish Government still persuaded that the not proven verdict should be abolished? And if you can outline, if so, why?
So the short answer, Convener, to your question is yes. The Scottish Government firmly believes that our law and our legal processes have to meet the needs of modern Scotland, of 21st century Scotland, and clearer and more transparent decision-making is an important part of that. As you've heard, Convener, during your evidence, many people do not trust a verdict that cannot be adequately explained. It causes trauma to victims, and it can leave a lingering stigma to the accused. It is a historic reform, and it's based on significant and long-standing concerns. And the fundamental for me, Convener, is that we should always be striving to increase confidence that our verdicts are returned on sound, rational basis, whilst ensuring balance and fairness to all parties. There is, I believe, broad support for this measure. Four political parties at the last Scottish general election had a commitment to the abolition of not proven in their manifesto, and it had strong support in the government's consultation as well.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And that just, I suppose, helpfully leads me on to my next question. In relation to the evidence we've heard, which does indeed reflect broad support for the proposal to abolish the not proven verdict. What we've probably been less clear about is support for the proposed jury size change from 15 to 12 and the associated majority required. Concerns have been expressed that this may make it harder to secure convictions. And indeed, the Lord Advocate expressed her concern about the proposal just last week while she was giving evidence. So I wonder if I can ask if the Cabinet Secretary has reflected on these concerns that have been raised, and if so, what is your view on what we've heard and how might you respond to those concerns?
Do you mind if I just clarify you? With you, Convener, are you asking me about jury size or jury majority or both?
Probably both.
Yeah. Okay. I'll start with jury size. Mm-hmm. So, jury size, Scotland is currently an outlier in that we have a jury size of 15. Most other comparable jurisdictions have a jury of 12. And the independent Scottish jury research, which was, you know, one of the largest studies of its kind, was able to look very closely, because it was simulated trials with mock jurors. It was able to look exceptionally closely at that process of deliberation and decision making. And what it found with regards to jury size, and perhaps this speaks to more, you know, common sense arguments as well, as this particular piece of research, is that they were able to hold constant some factors and look at the impact on decision making of various jury sizes. And in short, it found that there was no particular advantage to having a jury size of 15 in terms of the quality of those deliberations, but when the group was a little bit smaller at 12, that increased participation. There were, you know, less people not participating, and, you know, it came, you know, to that view, and that informed the government's view that because there was more participation, better deliberation, and kind of fewer dominant voices.
Okay, thank you. And I know members will have some more questions about the composition of juries and majorities.
So I didn't actually address the majority issue.
Oh, right, yes, I beg your pardon.
Which, to be fair, is a much more complex matter. You know, I mean, it is my view, convener, that there are very black and white arguments in favour of the abolition of not proven. And, you know, there's been a, you know, long-standing concerns, you know, supporting the abolition of not proven. However, there are, you know, some very different considerations around the jury majority. And in all of this, at the forefront of our mind is how we achieve two things. One is improve the experience for complainers in terms of overcoming barriers to access to justice. But it's also about protecting the integrity and balance of the system, and reducing any risk of miscarriages of justice. So there are some very fine judgments here to be made. I will explain why, on the basis of evidence, you know, the government is proposing that we move from the simple majority to a qualified majority of two-thirds, and why we are not proposing to do near unanimity or unanimity. But it is quite a complex area, convener. In short, I suppose Scotland, in terms of its jury structure and system, is an outlier. No other system has three verdicts. No other comparable jurisdiction convicts on the basis of a simple majority either. And as I intimated earlier, no other comparable system has a jury of 15 either. So again, when we looked at the evidence on this, and there's, I suppose, three sources of evidence. There is the Scottish jury research. There is also a recent meta-analysis, and there are other reports over the past 15 years that shows that when you move from three verdicts to two verdicts, you will increase conviction rates. You will do that, and for all crimes. And the research is quite, it's not quite as unequivocal in that if you move from three verdicts to two, that will increase convictions, but across all crimes and not just in sexual crimes. So therefore, we have opted to, as I said, move away from the simple majority, but not going to near unanimity because of the other protections in the system that exist that we, you know, may at your discretion get on to, and have opted for the two-thirds. And I'll leave my remarks there because I appreciate there'll be other questions.
Okay, thank you for that. Got quite a number of members wanting to come in, so I'll bring in Sharon Dowie and then Fulton McGregor.
Thank you. There's criticisms that there's been a lack of research going into the changing of the jury numbers. I'm just wondering, in the bill, it's changing the jury size to 12, which is like England and Wales, but we've put in a two-thirds majority, which is different from England and Wales. So I was just wondering why you decided to go down that road.
So, I mean, our proposition around the size of the jury is based on the Scottish jury research for the reasons that I outlined to the convener. And while I would acknowledge that the government's proposition around the abolition of not proven is also tied in with other reforms, both in terms of reducing the size of the jury, but also in terms of increasing the majority. I suppose where my own thinking has changed a bit, I mean, initially I would have described that as the three legs of the stool. I think in terms of jury size, there is the research I mentioned. I think there are common sense arguments. I think committee and parliament will come to a view on that. Where I think we do need to be really engaged and invested in is the debate and discussion around jury majority and what that jury majority should or shouldn't be as a result of the abolition of not proven, which we have overwhelming, I would contend, support for the abolition of not proven. I've touched on the data that's informed our view about moving to a two-thirds majority, both in terms of the Scottish jury research, which showed that the juries, when they were deliberating, when they came to a conclusion about which verdict to pass, that it in finely balanced trials, that this wasn't just a simple reflection on the assessment of the evidence, that actually the structure of our jury system had an impact on outcome. So, you know, the number of jurors, number of verdicts, and the jury majority in themselves, those structural issues influence the outcome. And that's why we want to increase the balance a little bit in terms of moving from a simple majority to the two-thirds qualified majority. And you'll have heard, you know, some support from that in terms of your evidence sessions. I suppose I'm thinking of the comments from Lord Matthews in particular. I would also point to that in terms of our own consultation, there was 52% support for a qualified majority. I would acknowledge that a consultation is not a vote or a plebiscite. I mean, these are you know, difficult, complex matters, and there was 40% support for the two-thirds. And also, if you don't mind, I hope this doesn't come across as a bit cheeky, but this committee in 2013 had made some reflections. I appreciate it's different personnel on the committee, But I suppose I'm just pointing to there's a history of evidence or a history of consideration here. So this in 2013, where there was an acknowledgement that if you abolish not proven, that you need to consider the jury majority because of the impact it could have on all cases across the board. And I'm also aware, and again, I hope members don't think I'm being cheeky here either, that there was a previous members' bill by Michael McMahon as well that supported the proposed abolition of not proven, and that bill was also tied into the two-thirds qualified majority. But I appreciate that these are judgments that we are all going to have to make together and navigate our way through, and there is a particular relationship between the not proven verdict and the majority, and various options that I'm sure we will continue to discuss and debate.
Sorry, can I just ask, did you say there was a 40% support for the two-third majority?
So there was 52% support in our consultation for a qualified majority, and of course a qualified majority could be at various levels, but there was 40% support in the consultation for this particular option of 8 out of 12.
So that's not really even halfway then?
Well, actually, the majority support was for a qualified majority as opposed to the simple majority. But as I say, it was a consultation. It's not a plebiscite. It's not a vote. I was just, reflecting on various strands of evidence. By contrast, in terms of, because you did ask about, forgive me, Ms. Dowie, you did ask about England, where their system, two-verdict system, they have near unanimity, mm-hmm. 10 out of 12. That option in our consultation was not popular. I think that received about 13% support. And there are other safeguards within our system as it stands. And in particular, notwithstanding the Lord Advocate's recent successful reference to the appeal court, we still have corroboration and as a mainstay of our system. And that would be one of the reasons that this government would not support going to near unanimity or unanimity.
Okay, thank you. Fulton McGregor, followed by Russell Finlay.
Morning to Cabinet Secretary and your officials. I did have some questions on that linkage between the removal of not proven and the changes in the jury that are being proposed. But I think you've actually given quite a good account of that, and I do feel that where the government were thinking around that is now a wee bit clearer for me, at least in my own mind. But some of the evidence that we have heard is that the changes to the majority will make convictions more difficult. I know that the Cabinet Secretary and your officials will have heard this evidence. It's been pretty... Not everybody that's been in front of us has said that, but there has been a large body of evidence saying that removing not proven and bringing in these changes to the jury will make it more difficult to get convictions in these type of cases. So I'm just wondering what you as the Cabinet Secretary and the government's response is to these issues that have been raised. What is your thinking on it? Do you believe that to be the case as well, or are you confident that wouldn't be the case?
So the evidence shows that if we, and the evidence is clear, that if we go from three verdicts to two, that will increase convictions across the board in all cases. And we need to ensure that we keep the balance and the integrity in our system. If on the basis that, so we're turning up the dial a little bit, and that's on the basis that there are other aspects, in particular how the jury system is constructed, that influences outcomes, particularly in finely balanced cases, as opposed to just the facts and circumstances. I mean, I suppose there are other more, and it is a balance, and I hear those voices, and it's the part of The bill that I think I have wrestled with most, it's part of the bill that I will continue to wrestle with most, because this is the balance about how we ensure that we minimise the risk of increasing miscarriages of justice. You've heard Lord Matthews talk about, you know, is a majority of one sufficient for decisions on innocence or guilt or beyond reasonable doubt in these most serious cases? And of course, it applies to all cases. You know, the jury reforms and the abolition of not proven will apply to all cases. And I suppose in many regards, you know, this part of the bill, you know, could be, you know, it's almost like a standalone reform. It's not unrelated to the experience of victims in terms of transparency and the very strong views that victims have, in particular about the not proven verdict. But the other parts of the bill, I suppose there's a much stronger correlation around, you know, improving that experience. And I suppose the only point I'm really trying to make, Mr. Fulton, is, you know, wherever we land on this, and indeed other matters, it's the confidence in our system to maintain fairness to all parties, whether that's the complainer or the accused.
Yeah, no, I do accept that. I think it is a very difficult job for the government and for committee to find that balance. But, you know, obviously, some concerns have been raised that that it could make it more difficult to get convictions under that system. But so I wanted to ask, is there anything built into the bill that would review that, if it's working, if it has become more difficult, or if it is leading to more miscarriages of justice, or whatever? Is there anything built into the bill to review it if it passes?
So suppose we've built a bill that is based on the substantial research that exists right now. We will build into the bill, I have no doubts about this, that there will have to be ongoing evaluation of the impact of the bill, whether that's a more collective impact or an evaluation of the impact of particular aspects of the bill.
Okay, thanks. Just one final question, if the so just to clarify, the government, the position of the government is that you are clearly tied, if you like, for want of a better word, to the removing not proven is tied to the jury sizes. You know, that's the government's clear view on that just now. There's not an option, for example, to still remove not proven but keep the jury size as it is, just as an example.
Well, I mean, ultimately, this will be what Parliament decides, you know, particularly as we proceed through stage two and stage three. I've outlined the government's position, our preference. You know, we will, of course, be continuing to engage in this issue. I'm very conscious of the evidence that the Lord Advocate made the other week, as well as the, you know, the contribution of Lord Matthews as well. I think the overriding point I really want to make is we have to give serious consideration, you know, and, you know, that there needs to be that ongoing depth of our mutual scrutiny, if I can put it that way, because of what the evidence tells us about the impact of moving from three verdicts to two.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. We've just got about 15 minutes left, and I've still got five members wanting to come in, so if we can have fairly brief questions and succinct answers, that would be helpful. So I'll bring in Russell Finlay and then John Swinney.
Thank you. Brief questions is my middle name. Good morning. The not proven is likely on its way out, but part four also deals with jury sizes, as we've heard. Now, reducing the numbers from 15 to 12 will require 8 out of those 12 to reach a guilty verdict, which we've also heard. This would be inconsistent with just about every comparable jurisdiction worldwide, where it's either unanimity or 10 or 11 out of 12. There's a comment we've received from the Faculty of Advocates that this would be, quote, an international communication that Scotland places less value in protecting its citizens accused of crime than any and every other nation with a jury system. And perhaps more surprisingly, Professors Fiona Leverick and Eamon Keane told us that they opposed the 8 out of 12 proposition in the bill. So what I'm struggling to understand is why Scottish Government want to get rid of one international anomaly not proven and effectively replace it with another, which is this two-thirds majority in a jury of 12.
So I would refute strongly some of the views with respect that have been expressed by the Faculty of Advocates here. We are removing a verdict that isn't understood by jurors, as Mr Finlay has acknowledged, and are seeking to make associated reforms that are clear, proportionate and balanced, that have at its core fairness to both the complainer and the accused. In terms of your more specific point, Mr Finlay, the existence of corroboration is one of the main reasons why I and the government would not support going to near unanimity or unanimity. So I understand what you're saying, that when you look at all these other comparable jurisdictions with a two-verdict system, that they are 10 out of 12 or 12 out of 12. But we don't have hung trials in our system, and we still have corroboration, notwithstanding the changes to corroboration as a result of the Lord Advocate's recent reference.
Sure. I think what surprises me is the fact the two professors who up until now hadn't expressed a position on the size of the required majority both said that they believed that this was a mistake. Is that something that you've taken on board or reflect on, or is that a fixed view now?
So I've worked very hard to meaningfully listen to a range of views on all aspects of this bill, because I genuinely believe that what complainers and the accused and what we all require is a debate of the highest standard. I've set out, you know, why our preference is to go to a two-thirds qualified majority, because we need to ensure that we've got, you know, the right protections and balance in the system. And our judgment is, bearing in mind corroboration, that going to unanimity or near unanimity would be more than is required.
And continuation of that line of questioning, the Crown Office and the Lord Advocate, perhaps unsurprisingly, support the proposal for the two-thirds majority, but they actually want to go a bit further than that. And where there's a case where, for example, 7 out of 12 believe the accused to be guilty, they would like to have the power, the mechanism to seek a retrial. They say they're in discussion with the Scottish Government about that. Have you taken that on board? Are you likely to amend the legislation to include this provision? Or do you think that would further exacerbate the concerns of those who I referred to in my initial question?
So just for clarity, and I really hope I haven't misheard Mr Finlay, in terms of the Lord Advocate's evidence last week, I don't think for a minute, and I, you know, will stand to be corrected, I don't think she was in any shape or form arguing for unanimity or near unanimity.
No, she wasn't. Sorry. No, she agrees that with the bill's provision, which is two-thirds majority.
Yeah, qualified majority.
But wanted to take it a step further in that they wanted to have an additional protection or mechanism of seeking a retrial if, for example, only 7 out of 12 believed in the accused's guilt. So just in terms of that request by the Crown for the bill to be amended to have the capacity to seek a retrial, is that something the government's agreed to or agreeing to?
So our consideration of that is at a fairly early stage. I would always seek to take seriously the views of the Lord Advocate, given her independent role. She has, you know, many years of experience, and in particular has a long-standing interest in, you know, seeking justice for complainers in sexual offence cases. So I think, you know,
it's not off the table. It's been considered.
No, it's, yeah, okay, I think that's fair. It's not off the table. I suppose I just want to just say something positive and something where, you know, where we need to be careful. I mean, what I wouldn't want to do is that in removing not proven, where we've, you know, moved towards taking out, you know, something that's seen as a third verdict or the compromise verdict in difficult cases. So we do need to, you know, keep clear positions. And I suppose one of the, you know, in our system thus far, you know, retrials hasn't been a feature. Our system has rested on the finality of verdicts. So I suppose in terms of transparency between me and committee, I suppose what I would want to explore further is whether the Lord Advocate has outlined or is looking for a system of retrial, or whether it's about more in line with adding in additional exceptions to double jeopardy legislation. But absolutely, there will of course be discussions.
I think the Crown's submission, submission was that in the event of a 7 out of 12, for example, they would be able to ask the court for a retrial. So, but yeah, thank you.
Thank you. John Swinney, followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Kavira. I'm going to continue on this line of argument or discussion because I was struck particularly last week by the comments of the Lord Advocate at column 12 in our official report, where the Lord Advocate indicated that she considered that the changes that are proposed will make it more difficult to get a conviction in the type of cases that we are talking about. And I think we have a bill in front of us where the objective is to ensure that we get to better outcomes in relation to the prosecution and conviction for sexual crimes. The situation the Lord Advocate expressed concern about does not materialise. So I'm very concerned that the abolition of the not proven verdict has been linked to the jury size question. I want to explain. It's jury size and the simple majority question. I'd like to explore that further because the not proven verdict, which Eamon Keane and Professor Leverick from the University of Glasgow helpfully explained to us, you know, the not proven verdict and the not guilty verdict amount to the same thing. Mm-hmm. And I think we've got to be blunt about that point. So I therefore would like to understand why, if those two verdicts amount to the same thing, is there a need for us to undertake any compensatory changes in relation to jury size and jury majority, given that the verdict we are proposing to abolish in this legislation amounts to the same as not guilty?
So I'm not going to repeat what I've said earlier, convener, other than to acknowledge that there are some very fine judgments in this, and that What I have to recognise is that there are indeed particular challenges with sexual offences cases. We will no doubt, you know, continue to pursue that. But I also have to recognise that the evidence as it stands shows that the balance is tilted when you move from three verdicts to two, and that the whole raison d'etre of, I suppose, all of our reforms is to absolutely improve access to justice, but to do so in a way that improves life and the experience for complainers, but doesn't compromise the rights of the accused. And I just wondered, Alistair, if there was maybe some further detail you would like to add to Mr. Swinney's question.
I suppose just to flag up some of the history. Sorry. Just to flag up some of the history you referenced. So as Lord Matthews said last week, not proven has always been seen as a counterbalance to the simple majority, and that goes back not just years but decades. You know, you can look at, for example, the Thompson Committee. So by that logic, it follows that if you abolish the not proven verdict, you should at the very least reconsider the majority for conviction. And the logic, as has been touched on by various people throughout the committee evidence sessions, is not straightforward. And Lord Matthews, I think, captured that in his comment that whether in sheer logic that is the case may be doubtful, but I think it probably does counterbalance it, because the logical case may not necessarily be straightforward, but in effect that seems to be what is happening. And of course, as the Cabinet Secretary said, it's contested, and you've heard views on both sides, but the data that we do have does support that view as well, further backed up by the fact that there's not a single other similar legal system in the world that we know of with two verdicts and a simple majority. Hence Lord Matthews telling the committee that the simple majority could be possibly conducive to miscarriages of justice.
But I think the difficulty I've got with all of this relates to the fine judgments that the Cabinet Secretary talked about, because I think the Cabinet Secretary, you've made clear that there has to be balance and fairness to all parties. But when I read the evidence of the Lord Advocate, I am worried that there is, as a consequence of this, the risk of imbalance in relation to complainants compared to where we are today. And the whole purpose of this legislation is because none of us are happy about where we are today. And I think the questions of the relationship between that has been constructed in this legislation, and I hear some of the background evidence as to why that's the case, but I think the government needs to explore whether there is sufficiently compelling evidence of the need for a compensatory action in relation to jury size and composition, given the fact that the not proven verdict amounts to the same as a not guilty verdict. And I think that issue, I would encourage the government to consider further whether the evidence exists to substantiate that point.
And I take that on board, convener. We're, you know, not at the end of stage one process yet. As I've said before, this bill is a marathon as opposed to a sprint. It is important to recognise that, and the jury evidence would show this, that the not proven verdict is seen as the compromise verdict. In a two-verdict system, juries, of course, don't have that option. They have to decide whether someone is innocent or guilty. At this point in time, as I said, not prejudging, the rest of the parliamentary process, it is the view of the government that we should make a small adjustment. A simple majority in a jury of 12 would be 7 out of 12. We are proposing 8 out of 12. But I'm also conscious, you know, that there continues to be a live debate, and the Lord Advocate touched upon this in and around the role of corroboration across our system. And I think the Lord Advocate spoke very powerfully on the impact of corroboration, you know, across all cases, but also in sexual offence cases.
Thank you.
Pauline McNeill, followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to your team. Cabinet Secretary, you're quite right to say that all the political parties had manifested a commitment to abolish a not proven verdict. I didn't take a view on my commitment to this bill, but it's not something I supported. However, we may have a consensus on abolishing the not proven verdict. But the problem, as you've heard in the lines of questioning, is how we get a consensus around the formulation of the change with the size and the majority of the jury. My first question, you said that so Scotland is an outlier, no other jurisdiction, but with the current proposals, Scotland would still be an outlier because no other jurisdiction has this majority. And is it your position, so I've understood it, is the reason for that going from saying we don't want to be an outlier, but we're still an outlier, is that because of, you'd be saying it's because of the corroboration that we have in Scots law that you're comfortable with still being an outlier in international arena?
What I am trying to do in this bill is seek as much consensus as possible, and through our consultation and the other you know, working groups and work that flowed from you know, the various research and, you know, other work, whether it's Lady Dorian's or other work that has underpinned this bill, is to, you know, in the interests of our justice system and its standing in our society, and in the interest of complainers as well as accused, is to build as much consensus as possible, and I will try and do that. I suppose we would consider our position as it stands now as, you know, doing our best to reach that consensus. And you're right, we are currently an outlier right now on three fronts. And, you know, three fronts in terms of the jury system, but also the way corroboration features in our system makes us different. So, you know, we have taken on board the research, we've taken on board the views that were expressed through the consultation, and yes, you know, the ongoing existence of corroboration, notwithstanding the Lord Advocate's successful reference to the appeal court, has meant that where we are just now is that qualified majority, that instead of the jury convicting on 7 out of 12, it would be 8 out of 12.
So does that mean, in answer to my question, that Scotland would still be an outlier, but you're comfortable with that because you think that we've got other things that other jurisdictions don't have? Is that what that amounts to, corroboration?
So even with the passing of all aspects of this bill, there will still be parts of our system that could be described as unique. Other you know, jurisdictions have, you know, I suppose...
So we're always going to be an outlier, is that what you mean? Always going to be different?
Well, I mean, I think in terms of...
I'm not giving a view
for ever and ever, you know, because that will be, you know, beyond any of us in this table. But in terms of...
No, but you could understand why I'm asking the question. Yes, if the argument for removing not proven is we're an outlier, we're still an outlier, but I don't particularly have a problem with that, because I think some features of our system are good. So anyway, I just wanted to understand
So we are an outlier with not.
We're
COVID,
still an outlier.
But but the evidence to abolish not proven is way beyond the evidence for the abolition. It far exceeds the fact that we are.
Yeah, I'm not arguing with that point.
And I suppose some people have argued for its retention,
To be fair, I think my assessment is, to be fair, even those who support it realise, there's a consensus to move on from it. And this is why I'm trying to understand, well, how do we then get a consensus around other things if we're going to remove it? Am I correct in saying, Cabinet Secretary, that you have put on the record that the purpose is not to, per se, increase conviction rates? Not the purpose.
This part of the bill is neither about increasing or decreasing conviction rates.
Yes. The research that you refer to, did you say meta-analysis?
Yes.
See, I was trying to establish if we were aware of this research.
Right.
And I don't know if we are, because what you said is that research said it would increase convictions, which is at odds with what the Lord Advocate said last week, where she, as John Swinney had said in his line of questioning, concerned about the Lord Advocate saying she think it will result in lower convictions. But your research shows otherwise. But I suppose the problem I've got is that I would have liked to have put that research to other witnesses. So is that something that we've been...
So
did we miss this?
I don't know what research or evidence that committee has purviewed or looked at. The meta-analysis that I was referring to was published last month.
Okay.
It is an independent bit of research by Jackson et al. It is a quantitative meta-analysis based on data sets from 10 different mock trials. And again, I was just pointing to this research, which, if it's helpful, we can share with committee, that the results were unambiguous, that there is, and I'll just quote here from the notes if you don't mind, that there is a statistically significant effect towards lower conviction rates under the Scottish three-verdict system than under an Anglo-American two-verdict system, and that the effect was found across a range of different offences, ranging from death by negligence to physical assault, rape, homicide.
Okay,
but we can share that.
Yeah.
It's not...
Just come in on that. I'm not aware that the committee had been made aware of that research, so the clerks are just looking at it just now, and we'll make sure that that's circulated to members.
Thank you. Just lastly, on the question that Russell Findlay raises, that the Lord Advocate raised with the committee, in cases where there's a 7-5 majority, so there would be no conviction then, which is what you've legislated for. Now, this question of whether or not the Crown should have the right for a retrial, and you said, well, you might look at the double jeopardy provisions to see if... I just wonder if you're prepared to give some assurances that any Stage 2 amendments, I suppose that's what we might be talking about here, would take into consideration that any right of the Crown, if you thought that's the direction of travel you wanted to go down, would be clearly set out in legislation. What I'm really getting at is I would not be content, whilst I think it's a fair point made by the Lord Advocate, we've got to consider that a future Lord Advocate may take a different approach than the current one. This Parliament should not give powers lightly away. If we've legislated for, if the Parliament does legislate as provided for in the bill, but feels there's should be some allowance for the Crown to retry, it should not be a wide provision. And I would be deeply concerned if the Parliament was not the final, had the final say in, because you can now, because you can't divorce it from what we're looking at right now. And I wonder if you could give me some assurance that if you're looking at it, you would make sure that it was a parliamentary decision. Does that make sense?
I think it always has to be a parliamentary decision because irrespective of the views or merits or otherwise is that in terms of retrial, that would be a significant departure from what we do now. Now, that's not to say it shouldn't be you know, considered or scrutinised, but it would nonetheless be a significant change that I would, you know, that I would contend that would need to be, you know, looked at properly, considered fully. But so I'm really just trying to assure committee that that we will consider the Lord Advocate's evidence. We've, you know, started that process, but also that, as with all legislation, it should be we need to be looking at the detail, and that where there are significant departures, you know, we'd have to think carefully whether stage two or stage three amendments are appropriate for that. That, you know, the answer to that may be yes or no. But it's just, you know, we need trying to really convey to committee that we really need to be all collectively be invested in the understanding and the debate around these very complex, difficult decisions.
Yeah, that's helpful. But just so for clarity, what I'm really getting at is, I mean, we've got to be open to that since the Lord Advocate mentioned it. What I'm really interested in, how if it's a provision which is wide in scope and gives the courts the power to decide what they would regard as, I would have concerns about a provision such as that. But if the provision was more tightly drawn, which is this is the criterion which the Crown, then I'd be more comfortable if that was something you were thinking about.
And I've certainly, and I have to acknowledge, Convener, that I've heard Ms McNeill in this committee actually make that point a number of times. Around scope and, you know, the careful decisions that need to be made around powers that are, you know, retained or other parts of the system that are given additional powers.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I've got a couple more members wanting to come in. We're running over time, but I mean, I think this is a vitally important conversation, so, or discussion, so I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay and then Katie Clark.
Thank you, Convener. I'm aware of time, so I'll keep my question brief. Conviction rates for rape are the lowest of any crime type. I think the Lord Advocate said it's 20% rate for single rape complainers, which is clearly quite shocking. You'll know that rape crisis are very concerned about the two-third majority in a 12-person jury and feel that it would make it harder you know, to get convictions, which is clearly the last thing that we want. We'll be going on to talk about the new sexual offences court. And this is quite a left field question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Do you envisage the government ever making a different sort of configuration or criteria for juries in that court when we talk about jury balance and sizes to try and balance out their fears relating to corroboration and all the rest of it? Is that something the government would ever consider, given that we're setting up a new court anyway?
Yeah, that is quite a left-field question, Ms Mackay, if you forgive me for saying. So, I mean, in terms of our proposition right now, is that the jury system operates across all offences, and I would think we would need to give very careful consideration as to whether you could actually have a different.
I completely appreciate. I'm just trying to sort of break the impasse between the particular problem with sexual crime convictions compared to the rest, and you know. Because I think we all understand rape crisis is concerned that if, you know, that in their opinion it's going to make it harder to convict because of the jury configuration, then it's not helping them.
And I mean, I understand and entirely accept that there are unique challenges around sexual offences cases. So when we look at the system overall, actually not proven is rarely used. It's 1% in summary cases, 5% in solemn cases, but it is used more frequently in sexual offences. I think perhaps the short answer to Ms Mackay's question is that we will, reflect on her question accordingly. I think there would be particular challenges around it, but it's perhaps better for me not to just give an off-the-cuff response. But
totally understand. Thank you, Convener.
Yeah. And Katie Clark, and then we'll move on.
Thank you. And Cabinet Secretary, you said that the evidence was clear in terms of the impact of removing not proven in terms of the number of convictions. But the evidence that we've heard is far more mixed. We weren't aware of the metadata evidence that you spoke to Pauline McNeill about, but we were aware of the other Scottish mock jury research that has been directed to us. But the views that we heard from the various witnesses that have come to speak to us is far more complicated, and I'm sure that the Cabinet Secretary will be aware of that. So, given that witnesses have also told us that providing a breakdown of jury decisions in terms of unanimous or majority and the exact numbers and breakdown in terms of outcomes from juries isn't available, wouldn't it be sensible to get that data before we make what are quite significant changes to the Scottish system in terms of jury majorities? We've been told that there's dispute as to whether we can do it legally in Scotland. There's been legislation passed down south to enable that kind of research to take place. Wouldn't it be sensible to have a better understanding of what actually happens now before making what are really significant changes to the system?
So my understanding, and I will pass to Alistair Bowden in a moment, is that it's the limitations around the Contempt of Court Act that places real constraints on live, real-life research, as, deliberations, happen in a real-life sense.
What we've been told is that there seems to be different views as to whether that is correct in Scotland, but irrespective of that, in England, to enable them to carry out this research, they changed the law to make it absolutely clear that it would be possible. I just wonder why, why rather than coming forward with what are quite controversial changes that go way beyond the manifesto commitments of the various political parties to abolish not proven, we're not trying to get our evidence base so that we make evidence-based policy and to actually enable us to do the collection of data and analysis to make those decisions. And that could be a legal change that could be incorporated, presumably, into this bill.
So I'm not... I suppose we may have a different understanding of what occurs or the changes that have been made south of the border, and that there may be different views on what the legal barriers are to really getting that information, that breakdown. So I don't know whether Alistair or whether Nicola, you want to come in either, if Alistair starts.
Happy to. So just for a bit of background, so it's not necessary to collect the data of how juries split in the current system, because the outcome is the same regardless. As long as if the threshold's reached for conviction, it's a conviction. If it's not, it's an acquittal. So they don't need to know the fine-grained details of how it's split. So that's why it's not collected now. And the reason I would say, I suppose, that firstly, the reason there's a downside of collecting it, which I'll come into, and also there's a question as to whether it would actually take us any further, which I'll then cover. So the downside, I suppose, is that the reason data on that kind of thing is not collected is for important reasons of public confidence. So if you could imagine, if a jury split 8-7, for example, as happens in the current system, because it's a simple majority, you can imagine how that might be covered in the press and on social media and what that might do to public confidence, whether it's a narrow conviction or a narrow acquittal. That would not be beneficial to anyone involved in that case. you know, in terms of stigma. And secondly, I suppose, and perhaps more importantly, I'm not sure that data would ultimately take us that much further forward, because if, for example, you found out that you know, a jury didn't reach a two-thirds majority in a particular case, so you might suggest, well, you can infer from that then on the new reform system that would have been an acquittal, but I'm not sure that you could, because under the current system they're directed they need a simple majority. In the new system they'd be directed, you know, if you want a conviction you need to meet a two-thirds majority. So what the jury did in the current system wouldn't be a reliable guide to what they would do if directed differently in a different system. So it might give you some idea, but I think we'd be a few years down the line and the same people would be questioning the data saying, well, what does it really tell you? So I'm just not sure it would kind of seal the deal in terms of evidence.
I don't think there's any suggestion that the outcomes would be publicised in individual cases. I think we're talking about research that would be across the board to begin to understand trends and what actually happens. And I'm just suggesting, I know we've got a shortage of time, and I'm not suggesting that I'm just, it's surprising that we're not trying to get a firmer evidence base, because I know the Cabinet Secretary says the evidence is clear, but that's not what other witnesses have said to her and said to us, and I'm sure she's heard the evidence.
Yeah, no, I mean, I appreciate that, Convener, that, you know, there's a range of views, but I've pointed to two, you know, substantive bits of research. Just in terms of the legalities, and if time's short, Convener, we can certainly follow up in writing. Mm-hmm. I just wondered if, Nicola, if you wanted to add anything.
Thank you, CAPSEC. Certainly in terms of the Contempt of Court Act, there is it's unlawful to question jurors or for them to reveal the particulars of the deliberations in the particular case, so they can't speak about the views they formed on the evidence they heard, why they voted the particular way that they voted. So there is that legal restriction. There isn't a restriction per se on speaking to people who have served on juries about their understanding of the system generally, but you do have to be very careful that you don't impact on straying into the territory of how they particularly deliberated in that specific case.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
We'll clarify the point whether you, my understanding, and you know, you don't stand to be corrected, is that while there is research south of the border in relation to people who have served on a jury, but that there are still limitations and you can't ask them about their deliberations on that particular jury.
I think that is correct.
The information we're asking for is quite basic, though. We're just asking for numbers, I hear what the Cabinet Secretary says.
Okay, we will have to move on. If there's time at the end, I'm happy to come back if members have further questions on part four. Okay, so thank you. So we're now going to move on to part five, which is the provisions in relation to the creation of a sexual offences court. So if I can again open up Cabinet Secretary. So you'll be aware that last week Lord Matthews gave evidence to committee during which he said, and I quote, "The judiciary is broadly speaking in favour of the proposal for a sexual offences court. We agree with the thinking of and conclusions drawn by Lady Dorian's review group for the various reasons that she has set out. Despite a number of statutory interventions over the years and the best efforts of everyone involved, the pace of change has been glacial and we have not been able to affect the cultural change that we think is needed because reform has been piecemeal." Now, we have, of course, heard other concerns about the proposal around resourcing, sentencing powers, and the ability of the Lord Justice General to remove judges. So I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary has had an opportunity to reflect on the evidence that we've heard, and is she able to provide some reassurance specifically around the concerns that have been raised?
Thank you very much, Convener. In terms of the views or concerns expressed regarding the Lord Justice General's power to remove judges, we have listened very carefully to those and are looking at potential amendments so that the situation is clear and unambiguous. There is an arrangement in terms of the appointment and removal of temporary judges, and it may be that we need to be clear in the bill, you know, to introduce provisions that, you know, mirror those arrangements. In terms of sentencing powers, I am firmly of the view that the Sexual Offences Court should have unlimited sentencing powers, and that is a departure from the original work undertaken by the original review. We absolutely should be guarding against any perception that this court is a downgrade. It is a court with status and should have the same powers as the High Court, given the gravity of some of the offences that it is dealing with. It will be transformative. You have heard lots of evidence in the opportunities when you build something from the ground up. The founding principle of this court is to improve the experience of complainers. Again, there is, you know, broad support for the establishment of this court with national jurisdictions and being able to operate in around, you know, 40 venues across the country. And it is within the gift of us all to really shape how this new court is seen. Inevitably, in terms of resources, convener, the financial memorandum, you know, outlines, you know, set-up costs and ongoing costs. So inevitably, you know, there are costs, and that, you know, will be, you know, we will be constantly, you know, looking at that from now to implementation, because as we know, costs it can of course change. But in the longer term, you know, there are, you know, potential savings around more efficient use of court resources, and, you know, we've already within the system seen the benefits of really good judicial case management. You know, we've seen the benefits of that in other courts. But in essence, you know, we are talking about, you know, around 700 cases that are, you know, currently within our system, both in terms of sheriff and jury and in the solemn cases in the High Court. So it is about, it's also about, you know, the more effective management of those cases, which was, I suppose, at the heart of Lady Dorian's review, that, you know, we are now dealing with, you know, a huge increase in these cases in comparison to 10 years. So thought needed to be given to the efficient case management of these particularly difficult cases in the interests of justice being served and, of course, in the interests of complainers.
I'm just going to move straight to members, and I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay, then Pauline McNeill.
Thanks very much, convener. I know we've moved on from the previous part of the bill, but I did find the testimony from Mr Bowden to be quite staggering in respect of the explanation given about not having data on how juries are split. You know, we've got a bill in front of us which is going to fundamentally alter that, yet we don't know anything about how they've previously been split. And the rationale of the government appears to be that we don't need to know this. We don't need to know what was described as the fine-grained details, and that the public and the media perhaps can't be trusted to know it. And it, even, I think, Katie Clark's line of questioning yielded the fact that if that's the case, why on earth can researchers not get this basic information? I find it mind-blowing, frankly, that we're being asked to radically alter juries and jury sizes and jury ratios when no one within the criminal justice system has sought this information. But I'll ask one question about Part 5. I know others want to come in terms of trauma-informed practice, which is obviously central to Part 2, also features in the Sexual Offences Court in Part 5. Now, last November, NHS Education for Scotland gave evidence to the committee saying that their definition of trauma-informed, which is a five-part definition, was not being used for the bill. Two parts of their five-part definition were omitted. And what they said is this may also hinder the effective implementation of other elements of the bill. And when I asked you, Cabinet Secretary, whether you would consider their request to think again on this, you said that your door was always open. So I suppose the question is, have the NHS been through your open door? And have you agreed to their request for the five-part definition to be part of the bill? Or is that now, have you now ruled it out?
So, convener, just in terms of the right to reply on the preamble to Mr Finlay's question, I think I have laid out today that we have lots of evidence, that we've also laid out that there are some ethical and legal considerations about the type of evidence that can be gathered and how. I would always accept the argument that there's always a case to seek more evidence, but we also have to, you know, acknowledge that there can be other limits in and around that, and that we can continue to seek evidence, you know, for ever and a day without actually ever implementing any of that evidence. But I accept, and particularly as Ms Clark pointed out, you know, that there is a balance. In terms of actually the very important question around trauma-informed practice, there is a difference between the definitions that are required in practice, and then there are, of course, what has to be expressed in terms of the context of the law. And just let me reassure Mr Finlay, my door is never closed, and that we are continuing to engage with a large number of stakeholders.
Have they been through your door in respect of this particular request?
They've not been through my specific door in my office at this up to this moment in time. I hope that's not too much information for you, Mr. Finlay.
No.
But you know, the work that was led by NHS and Dr. Bruce in terms of the trauma-informed framework is particularly important to us, and it's particularly valued.
Are you going to change the bill?
I'm looking at it.
Right.
But okay. You, with respect, you know, I will want to...
Sure. I mean, it's been about 3 months since they raised this in this written submission to the committee. I put it to you then, and we're 3 months down the line. And
I know you're impatient. But
on the table or off the table?
It's on the table.
Right. Okay.
I don't know. Is there anything from a more legalistic point of view that you'd like to add? No.
I wonder if I might just come in very briefly just to say that it is something that we've been exploring with the justice partners to whom the definition would apply. So we really do need to understand what it would mean if we change the definition that we had in the bill to something broader. So it's absolutely something we are exploring.
Are there timescales attached to that?
Well, I think we have.
We've got a stage two timetable and a stage three timetable that we'll all have to adhere to.
Sure, but if you as the government want to change your own bill, you surely have to get on with it.
I do, and in terms of due process, with respect, Mr Finlay, and respect to the committee, before I lay out you know, responses to Parliament and then around our intentions to stage two and stage three, I would like to see the committee's stage one report.
Okay, thank you.
Pauline McNeill, followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. Can I premise my remarks by saying I think that the proposal for a specialist court is the most significant proposal in the bill. But I have to say I think the government put themselves in danger of losing the consensus over it. So my line of questioning relates to that. So my first question is, what is the reason that you did not fully adopt Lady Dorian's suggestion? As you said, Cabinet Secretary, you don't think this court should be considered to be a lower court, but in fact it will be. But if you'd adopted Lady Dorian's recommendations for it to be a parallel court, there would be no question over this at all. And I've got questions in right of audience in it to illustrate why I think it will be seen as a lower court. So my question is, what is the reason I know you weren't Cabinet Secretary when the legislation was drafted, so I'd be happy to have your officials want to come in and say it just seems extraordinary for Lady Doreen to do this work, come up with a proposal that everyone thinks is a good one, but dilute it by saying it's not going to be a parallel court to the High Court. I really don't understand it.
I suppose I come from... I suppose I'm looking at the mountain from a different side here, and I will come to officials in a moment. While we have, you know, taken the spirit and the vast, vast majority of the detail from Lady Doreen's report, and actually I would contend that some of the changes around, you know, unlimited sentencing power actually enhance, you know, the status of the report, the court. So I suppose, I mean, I'm genuinely struggling to see why, you know, this would not be seen as a court of
status. Okay, well, let me help you then. Well, it's not the High Court, we've established that. It's a national court with wider sentencing powers, but in the hierarchy of the court system, it won't be as high as the High Court. Is that right?
So we're not.
It can't be.
We're not grafting a court, this new court, this new way of working, this new court that is, you know, built from the ground up. We're not grafting it on to existing court systems, purely because that will mean that, you know, changes will be iterative as opposed to seismic. But Andrew, you've been you have longevity in this issue.
I do, yes. So I guess the reason for establishing the court is about managing those cases differently. So it's less about status, it's about ensuring that we have a court that improves the experience of victims while continuing to do that in a way that's fair for the accused. So it's not necessarily about having a parallel court, it's about doing it the right way for victims. And that's really the rationale and the reasoning that's gone into the court and establishing the court, make sure we do it the right way.
But Lady Doreen had specifically said that she thought it should be a parallel court, but you didn't go for that. I just wondered why. I hear what you're saying, and I totally support the government in this regard. It's about changing the experience and doing things differently. I'm totally in support of that. But my question is, why did you not adopt Lady Doreen's suggestion it should be a parallel court? Then we wouldn't be having this argument about whether you've lowered the status of sexual offences or not. Do you see what I mean?
I'm not sure she did suggest it should be a parallel court. With respect, that wasn't my reading of the recommendations made by Lady Doreen. She suggested a model of sexual offences court which shared a number of similarities with the High Court, but also suggested a number of differences from the High Court in terms of its sentencing powers, in terms of its rights of audience, jurisdiction, etc. In the process of developing the court, we've engaged with a variety of stakeholders to look at the model of court and the differences that have emerged with what Lady Doherty suggested in her review have come about as a process of that engagement with stakeholders. So yeah.
Thank you. So one of the examples I wanted—you probably heard me ask these questions about rights of audience—and that is shared by the senators about a change to the rights of audience. So, and forgive me, because as a layperson, I'm trying to fully understand this. But despite the restriction in relation to rape and murder, the types of cases where a solicitor would be able to represent the accused in the sexual offences court would include ones which are currently prosecuted in the High Court, thus allowing solicitors to represent an accused in a broader range of serious cases. The bill will allow that to change so that a procurator fiscal deputy can prosecute at section 47.6. So what's happened here is that for some offences, with rape excluded, murder excluded, there will be a change to the rights of audience. Surely you must see that will be seen as lowering the status of the court. Because we have these rules for a reason. We've had, you know, years of differences between advocates, solicitor advocates, and who can represent an accused person who is facing 8 or 9 years in jail. So is that something that came about by deliberate provision or accident, or could you elaborate?
So, I mean, I'll start off with this in terms of rights of audience. So obviously the Sexual Offences Court is, I suppose, a hybrid court in that it can, you know, deal with all those, you know, High Court solemn cases, as well as those serious sheriff and jury cases as well. But in terms of how it is constructed, I mean, we've been very clear that there is no diminution in the quality or the status of representation that is available to the accused. There are, you know, particular cases in terms of those High Court cases that has to be, you know.
But there is, I'm sorry to challenge you on this, but there is, because those cases that went to the High Court would retract rights of audience from advocates and solicitor advocates. The spice breathing is quite clear, because it's not the High Court. It is possible for solicitors who currently cannot represent certain categories of cases. I mean, the spice briefing is quite clear about this, and I didn't understand why you would have legislated in that way.
Yeah, I think my point was, while, you know, Andrew, you can keep me right, that, you know, while there is, you know, opportunity for solicitors to be dealing with, you know, a broader range of cases, but in terms of those cases that currently go to the High Court, there is no diminution in terms of the representation that is available for the accused.
There is. Can you just... The vice briefing is quite clear. Andrew, if you could answer that, would be helpful.
Yeah, absolutely. So the rationale behind the rights of audience that we've arrived at is for the court is, again, obviously the Lady Dorian review suggested that it should be only those with higher rights of audience. But during the process of engaging with partners on this, there was a concern that because of the fact that the Sexual Offences Court would be taking both High Court and Sheriff Court cases, that would significantly increase the workload on advocates and solicitor advocates, and they would be required to do cases that were previously heard in the Sheriff Court and that previously had a solicitor would have been able to appear in those cases. During the process of engaging with the working group, we came to a conclusion that the way to do it would be to protect rights of audience, so require that solicitor advocates and advocates only appear in murder cases and rape cases because they are currently pleas to the Crown and therefore only can only be tried in the High Court. So wish to mirror those provisions in the bill in the Sexual Offences Court.
Right, so for reasons of workload, you decided to broaden out the scope of who could represent accused persons in other cases that are not rape and murder. Do you think that is fair to an accused person? That they now would not necessarily, where they previously would have the right to be...
So my apologies, Ms. McNeill. I think I've understood your question from the wrong angle. I mean, the position of the government is that we... you know, didn't want solicitor advocates or sort of counsel cases, you know, having to, you know, be, you know, compelled to to represent cases that they wouldn't normally be involved in. I mean, there is an underlying issue here in terms of ensuring that there is, you know, the appropriate legal aid available in terms of...
Sorry, but I think Andrew had just said, if I've understood, the reasons of workload, you have allowed for a provision for solicitors to represent cases where previous would have been counsel,
get to that point, and I'll ask Lisa to address that.
Ms. McNeill, if it's okay just to come in on that, and I think that Andrew's absolutely right in when he was describing some of the discussions that we had in the working group with, you know, representatives cross-sector to look at this. Because the court is seeking to take the High Court caseload as well as the sheriff and jury load caseload, that obviously expands the caseload. And the discussions within the group did look at, is the current complement of advocates and solicitor advocates able to cope with such an expanded mm-hmm. caseload per the recommendation of Lady Dorian? Lady Dorian did, as you say, recommend that the rights of audience should be identical to the High Court, and we have departed. And the reason that we've departed for that is partly because of those workload problems
right.
in relation to those sort of sheriff and jury cases that the court will hear. There was some discussion about those cases are currently represented by solicitors in the sheriff and jury courts. It currently presents a development opportunity for solicitors. It's something that solicitors have as
so it's a development opportunity you're giving solicitors to represent accused persons. And I think we need clarity.
Sorry,
because you can understand my concern is...
May I continue about the
sure.
But that's the split that we were trying to recognise in the court. Because it's bringing together High Court cases and sheriff and jury court cases, we weren't satisfied that there was a need to change the rights of audience, if you like, in terms of the sheriff and jury court cases. But for High Court cases, there's no intention for cases that would otherwise have been called in the High Court to not have legal aid access to counsel and solicitor advocates. The difficulty in being able to set this out in the bill in terms of rights of audience is because, as you say, only rape and murder are within the exclusive jurisdiction of the High Court. The other cases that are heard in the High Court in relation to sexual offences are ultimately the discretion of the Lord Advocate and of prosecutors. So it's very difficult to be able to reflect that sort of distinction within this hybrid court. But what we are doing is exploring with the Scottish Legal Aid Board how we can make sure that there is the right mechanism in place to allow legal aid for counsel in cases that would otherwise have appeared in the High Court. There's no intention to try and change that type of representation. It's simply how it's reflected in the bill because of the hybrid
right.
jurisdiction.
Well, I would welcome further discussion on this. I know Katie wants to come in a supplement. And this is really important because this is a significant proposal which, without resolving this, in my opinion, would give me difficulty in supporting these provisions in the bill, to be perfectly truthful with you. I know I've mentioned this before, and I apologise to mention it again, but when we increased the sentencing powers of the Sheriff Court in 2004, the Legal Aid Board eventually refused to sanction advocates for cases that previously would have been heard in a higher court. Ask any of the profession. So the problem is that if the less the Legal Aid Board give you assurances, accused persons who would otherwise have been properly represented by senior counsel or junior counsel will no longer, by your own admission, be automatically entitled to that. And if you leave it to the Legal Aid Board, the same will happen as happened in 2005. Serious cases that are indicted in the Sheriff Court will no longer attract a higher level of representation. And I have to say that is throwing the baby out of the bathwater if we don't close the door on this. And the Cabinet Secretary opened by saying, you don't want this to be seen as a lower court. Well, it will be. It will be if you don't resolve these issues. So, sorry, I would be happy if...
We will, convener, make sure that we are learning all the relevant lessons from history. If there's a requirement by committee for us to timorously write to you in detail in terms of the exchange that officials have had with Ms McNeill, we will do that, and we will do it.
I would be really grateful because it's given me what real cause for concern. I'm happy to leave it there, but I don't know if Katie wanted it or something.
I'll bring Katie Clark in, and then I will bring in the other members. I know you've got a supplementary.
Given everything that Pauline McNeill has said about previous experience, do you not accept that we need clarity in terms of the black letter of the law? It doesn't matter what politicians' intentions are. It doesn't actually matter what assurances or correspondence there is with this committee. What matters is what the law will be. And if you are going to set it up this way as a separate court, then there needs to be clear rights. The alternative, of course, would have been to have specialist divisions of the Sheriff Court and the High Court, which many people would argue for. They could be very, very different from the way things are at the moment with their own, you know, rules of court. But you've chosen this pathway, and if you choose this pathway, surely you must accept that there must be absolute clarity in terms of the black letter of the law, that the rights of those involved will not in any way be reduced. And would the Cabinet Secretary accept that?
So I'd accept that the law needs to be unambiguous and clear mm-hmm. as possible. There's always a distinction between what is in the black letter of the law and what may follow through, you know, further regulation mm-hmm. or guidance. But that need for that clear pathway and that clarity and mutual understanding and in terms of what is and isn't on the record. And, you know, we will seek to give comfort to members as we proceed with stages 2 and 3. I just wondered, Lisa, is there anything else you would like to add at this point?
No, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I think that's a good point. We'll continue to explore what mechanism we might be able to look at to give that reassurance. And just very, very quickly to pick up on your point, Ms Clark, about the specialist divisions, that was something that the working group did consider and did discount as not providing the change at the scale at which it's needed.
I think you have to accept that politicians will presume there may be a cost-cutting agenda here, because that is the experience in the past, as I think Pauline has outlined, giving one example, but there's other examples.
OK, thank you. If I can bring in Sharon Dowie and then Rona Mackay.
Thank you. In your response to the convener, you had said the words build something from the ground in relation to the Sexual Offences Court. And in your reply to Pauline McNeill, you had said it would be a new court built from the ground up. So I was wondering if you can tell me what the difference would be between a Sexual Offences Court, which we know is not going to be built from the ground up, it's actually used in the current estate that we've already got, and the current High Court, which will be required to accord with trauma-informed practice following the passage of the bill.
So, thank you for that. I was actually paraphrasing Lady Dorian in terms of building this new court and new structures and new rules and new practices and new philosophy, and and again, to paraphrase Lady Dorian, it was that clean sheet approach. I think the advantage of the national jurisdiction aspect is that this court will be able to sit in nearly 39, so I can't read more in handwriting, will be able to sit in around 40 courts facilities around the country, and therefore, you know, it can have a presence, an appearance in localities, you know, nearer to local justice. So it's 39. So this court can appear in 39 locations, whereas the High Court can currently appear in 10 locations. So I would contend that this court of national jurisdiction, in terms of where it can appear, is in line with trauma-informed practice.
So will you be able to put all the adjustments? Because obviously the victims groups that we've heard from are obviously saying they're wanting separate entrances, separate exits, separate areas, so that the accused don't come into contact with victims. So will you be able to do that in the current estate?
So the fabric of the court estate is, of course, a fundamental point, and, you know, continuing to make improvements in the court estate is something that the government is committed to. Perhaps Ms Dowie is aware that in terms of the draft budget, there is not only a 9.5% increase in resource funding for courts, but there's also a capital increase of 28%. So that's a significant uplift in recognition that we do have to continue to invest in the fabric of our buildings to ensure that all the correct arrangements are made, you know, for the safety, security and well-being of victims and witnesses.
Okay. Another one on the training. So what training would you expect parties involved in the Sexual Offences Court to undertake, and how would that be different from the trauma-informed practice set out in Part 2 of the bill?
So there is, you know, that will be a detail that will be worked through with the experts in sexual offences, the experts in trauma-informed practice, as well as the courts who have to ensure that whoever appears, that all the participating parties in the new sexual offences courts have, you know, undertaken the requisite training for that. It's an important point in terms of the training for professionals who will be supporting the operation of that court. So that work in terms of with our partners, our justice partners, in terms of how that work will be, you know, developed, and crucially how we implement that, and of course the substantial work in terms of what is required was undertaken with the publication of the trauma-informed skills framework for the justice sector as a whole that we debated in Parliament. So we know what trauma-informed practice and what trauma-informed training should look like. What my officials are engaged with, particularly with our partners in the court, is the mechanisms and how, as part of the implementation process of the court, how all of that would be rolled out in advance of the court becoming operational.
So those that are going to be in the sexual offences court will get more training than the part two of the bill.
I think that's possible, but I mean, I, you know, the there's clear duties in the bill in terms of the participants and agents across the justice system, but in terms of those who can participate in the sexual offences court, you know, they will have to have undergone trauma-informed training. It's not really for me to say, to define, I suppose, the content and the nature of the courses with respect, but you know, I suppose it'd be a matter for the sexual offences court that there may be a view that there's additional training required.
Okay. So you'd mentioned the budget earlier on, and that's one of my concerns as well, the financial memorandum and how much money this will cost and will we be allocating enough money to it. So the Lord Advocate also raised doubts about financing, stating that the Crown Office struggles for finances presently and possibly in the future. So my question would be, how has the Scottish Government considered how it will finance the Crown Office more appropriately?
Well, I'm very pleased to say again, Ms Dowie, as a result of the draft budget that's in place with Parliament right now for Parliament's consideration, that there is a proposition for a sizeable uplift for the Crown Office of 11.66%. That equates to £21.2 million. And over the piece, I know there's been an in excess of a 50% increase into resources put into the Crown Office since the start of the last Parliament. If I share some more recent figures, 2019-20, the resource input into the Crown Office was £113 million. In terms of what's in the draft budget, that's now £203 million. So that, over the piece, has been a sizeable increase. Obviously, the Crown Office, like me, negotiate with the Finance Secretary every year around the budget going forward. But I think in terms of looking at past investment, the Crown Office has benefited from significant additional investment that has been put in place, particularly in terms of resource, but actually also, again, in terms of capital and some other non-cash supports as well. So that the overall increase in the past few years, from 2019-20, the investment goes from nearly £121 million to do the total investment in the draft budget at £223 million.
Okay, I suppose my concerns over the budget is whether we're putting the right resources in to achieve the aim that we want, and whether it's a real-term increase and whether it covers everything that's going to be required to put all the training in for this bill. One of the statements that we heard from somebody was that if we'd better prepared witnesses, then we would probably get the outcome at the verdict that they were looking for. But if we get the verdicts, which means that more guilty people are actually going to go to court, go to prison, then that's going to increase the prison population. And we already have issues with the prison population just now. And within the budget, even to get people out of prisons for community payback, we've got criminal justice, social work, basically saying that they've had a flat cash settlement for the last 4 years. So I still have concerns around the whole financial memorandum and whether we're putting the required funding into all the areas of the service that will require it.
Convener, I mean, at the end of the day, and I'm not going to go into the prison population issues because, as I said yesterday in reply to Mr. Finlay, in the not-too-distant future, I will come back to Parliament and make a statement in and around that, and will be, I suppose, refuting some of the remarks that Ms. Dowie has made, and point to, again, the investment that's in the draft budget around criminal justice, social work. But just, so I'll just lay all that to one side just now. But at the end of the day, we all want guilty people to be convicted, and we all want victims to receive the very best of support so that they can give the very best of evidence. And I think it's always fair to scrutinise resources. It is, of course, fair of me to say that the government's funding hasn't kept pace with real terms. So we've actually, in terms of our block grant funding, had a 1.2% real terms reduction. That equates to half a billion pounds. And then that's even before we get to capital, which will contract by 10% in real terms over the next 5 years. But nonetheless, in terms of the investment in the Crown Office, both in terms of resource and capital, and our investment in terms of resource and capital in the court system, has, despite the real terms cuts to what the government as a whole has to play with, we have a very good settlement in comparison to other areas in the justice budget, and there is a particular significant increases, 11%, 10%, in some cases 28% to budgets that I would hope would give some comfort to Ms. Dowie, and I hope she'll support the budget when we come to that point in our parliamentary timetable.
I'm sure we'll have more conversations than that. Thank you.
Okay. Got two more members wanting to come in, and then we'll be having a break. So I'll bring in Rona Mackay and then Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I wanted to ask you about floating trial diets. I think it's generally accepted that they're not a good thing. They've caused great distress to complainers and uncertainty. And the Lord Advocate has said that she would like to see them disappear. So my question is, do you think the Sexual Offences Court will alleviate that, the problem of that? And is it at all possible to legislate for the end of them, or is that best left to the independent judiciary?
So I'm very supportive of reducing the use of floating trials. I very much recognise the anxiety and uncertainty that they can cause. I would also have to recognise that delays cause trauma and anxiety to complainers as well, and victims and witnesses. And I am conscious that there is a different perspective, both from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal system to that has been expressed by the Lord Advocate and other victims groups. Very much would like to see a reduction in the use of floating trials. In terms of the Sexual Offences Court, they will have the opportunity to set their own rules so it will be a matter for them. Colleagues will be aware that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal System wrote to committee, I think in the past week, where they put forward evidence that 97% of trials call within the float period. And they provided other information that if floating trials were banned altogether, they are saying that that would add 22 weeks to the process. So we do need to take some care in this area, and an outright ban may have other consequences, particularly whilst the court recovery programme still continues. But it's another example of why the use of pre-recorded evidence is also important as well. But I appreciate it's a very live issue with different views.
Thank you. And Russell Finlay.
Got a very quick question. I didn't realise we'd be going off at a tangent talking about budgets, and I know we don't have the time to counter some of what was said as much as I'd like to, but my question relates to the remit of the Sex Crimes Court. Lady Dorian believes it should not include crimes such as murder, as do others. Is the government's position fixed on that, that it will do so?
So, again, it is quite correct, a point of divergence from the original report. It's my understanding and actually my acceptance that there were some points raised by the Crown and the Lord Advocate in particular in and around this that we have sought to take on board. Ultimately, the discretion in terms of what offence goes where in those cases where there is a murder but there's a sexual element to it, that of course would remain ultimately the decision of the prosecutors in terms of where that goes, whether that's the Sexual Offences Court or whether it was the High Court. And the rationale, and I'll try and be brief, convener, is that quite often in a sexualised murder, there will be other surviving witnesses. So people who, will be called to give evidence on the offence that's been tried.
It's a case right now, in fact. Yeah.
And, so there will be other surviving witnesses who've experienced sexual abuse or a sexual offence. Yeah. And it's so there's the flexibility in terms and acknowledging the needs of those victims and witnesses.
Can I just flexibility. Come in on that, sorry to interrupt, but therefore it's going to stay in the bill?
Right now, Mr. Finlay,
the prosecution have the discretion.
Yeah. So right now, Mr. Finlay, my view is that, and my preference, if I can put it this way, my preference is that the Crown should have the discretion in these sexualised murder cases, whether it goes to the Sexual Offences Court or to the High Court. But also, I want to acknowledge and put on record that there are very sound reasons for why such a case could and should go to the Sexual Offences Court, bearing in mind the needs of surviving victims and witnesses.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So I think we will now have a comfort break for around about 5 minutes or so, and so I'll suspend this meeting.
Okay, thank you. So we'll now continue our session and we'll move on to part six, which is the proposals around the juryless trial pilot. So I wonder if I can just, as usual, kick off questions. So, Cabinet Secretary, you'll obviously be aware of the concerns that have been raised about the proposed pilot of rape trials without juries. So, for example, the Faculty of Advocates has indicated that it strongly opposes the pilot, stating that it would compromise the rights of the accused, and the Scottish Listers Bar Association have said that they will not take part in a pilot. So I'm just interested in your response to the concerns that have been expressed and whether you've had an opportunity perhaps to have any engagement or discussions with some of the bodies that have been particularly opposed to the proposal.
Thanks very much, Convener. It is very core, the proposition around a pilot for a single judge rape trial comes from, as you well know, the work of Lady Dorian. And the essence of that is to examine in greater depth via that time-limited pilot to ascertain the effectiveness and of such a pilot and how it's perceived by everybody involved, and essentially to enable the issues to be assessed in a practical rather than a theoretical way, and to have an informed debate. And, you know, my view is that it's a in that regard, it's an unrivalled opportunity to look at what, if anything, is next, bearing in mind the long-standing concerns in and around prevalence of rape myths in our society and in juries, and those long-standing concerns also about conviction rates. In terms of my discussions with people who have concerns, I can assure the committee that I've had many discussions with people and organisations who are opposed to the pilot as proposed by Lady Dorian. And, you know, my commitment to, whether it's bar associations or indeed the Faculty of Advocates, is to continue with those discussions. While I would strongly refute any suggestion that there is anything in this pilot that undermines the rights of the accused, given, you know, the role of written statements, and that actually single judge trials is not a novel experience within our justice system as it stands. Nonetheless, you know, I remain more than willing to that open dialogue. In terms of how the, you know, criteria is crafted, in terms of how the pilot will operate, in terms of how it is evaluated, mm-hmm. To give as much assurance as possible to those who have concerns.
Thank you. And that kind of helps me come in nicely with my follow-up question, which was actually around what you anticipate the pilot would explore. So, for example, is it seeking to look at the impact on conviction rates, the experience for survivors, resource implications? So interested just to get a wee bit more detail on what the pilot is seeking to, what questions the pilot might be asking and what it's seeking to evaluate.
Okay. So, as I said, Convener, the purpose of the pilot is to gather evidence, empirical evidence, to inform the debate on how our justice system can most effectively respond to rape or attempted rape cases. And it's posing the question that whether or not changing the decision maker, you know, whether that improves the complainer's experience and whether that removes barriers to justice. And this is one area that the working group that there was three working groups that flowed from Lady Dorian's work, and there was a particular working group with respect to the pilot. And, you know, so there's three broad strands to, I suppose, the purpose of the pilot and in terms of what it's trying to elicit information on. And firstly, that is, you know, how is it, you know, perceived by everyone involved, you know, whether that's the victim, the accused, lawyers. And also, secondly, what impact the pilot has on the effectiveness and efficiency of the trial process. And in some of my discussions with the members of the legal establishment, they speak to, I suppose, a different atmosphere, different tone, I suppose, perhaps in a different skill set that's utilised when a case has been made to a judge as opposed to a jury. Would that lead to more focused deliberations? You know, is it a more efficient process as well as a more you know, victim-centred process? And, you know, the third strand is, so, you know, what would be, you know, the impact on outcomes? I'm not going to prejudge, you know, the outcomes in any pilot. I mean, the word time limited is there for a purpose. It's not a pilot that can, you know, go on in perpetuity. The pilot would have to be evaluated. A report would have to be, you know, laid in Parliament, and then, you know, it would be for Parliament to, you know, make a decision whether there was no further action or whether there was a continuation of this proposition or whether there was a development of another proposition. So it is a proposition for a time-limited pilot.
OK, thank you. OK, I'm going to open it up to members and I'll bring in Russell Finn.
Thanks, Convener. Is the Scottish Government's motivation behind the juryless rape trials to increase conviction rates?
So it would be wrong of me to portray this as a tool that's like a lever or a button that can, you know, increase conviction rates. I mean, I am on record as expressing deep concern about conviction rates. So we, you know that, you know, over a five-year piece, you know, conviction rates for rape, attempted rape, are 46%, you know, in comparison to, you know, about 84% for other crimes. When you disaggregate different types of rape cases, in terms of the so-called acquaintance rape, you know, that conviction rate, according to the Lord Advocate, is around 20-25%. There is a difference in conviction rates between adults and children, you know, children where there's been an offence under, I think it's Section 18 of the Sexual Offences Act, that has a higher conviction rate of over 70%. And then for adults where the offence has been prosecuted under Section 1 of the Sexual Offences Act, it's, you know, about 35% from memory. So I can't not be concerned about that. I have to respect the independence of the courts and judiciary, and indeed I'm under a legal obligation to do so. But I want to find the right way, and I want to look at the evidence without prejudging. because we can't ignore these conviction rates. So
that's one of the reasons, therefore, or the reason.
It's you know, my concern, and it's not just my concern, it's across a number of well-respected legal people and victims and witnesses groups. But much of the bill, including the pilot, comes from that place of concern about the consistently lower conviction rates for offences such as rape and attempted rape.
And we've heard evidence about how the pilot will be assessed. And apparently the only measure of assessment will be conviction rate.
No, I don't know where you get that impression.
It was
sorry,
the evidence
forgive
we heard
me.
Yesterday.
Sorry?
We heard evidence yesterday to that effect.
Well, not from you.
I'm just saying the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association believed that the only measure...
Well, I'm deeply surprised at that. And as you've heard me just a few moments ago, probably speak at length to the convener and outlined in very, admittedly very broad terms, what the evaluation would look at. Like, yes, it would look at outcomes and whether, you know, there's a conviction or acquittal, you know, that is an outcome, but there is so much more to the pilot. And I'll be absolutely, up front with you, Mr. Finlay, I am not opposed. I am not anti-jury. There's a real value
to
juries.
I mean, I'm just amazed this work's not been done in respect of existing trials. That's perhaps what surprises
me.
We've already addressed
that earlier
there's
today.
There's been talk of a boycott. If that came to pass, are you confident that the courts would still be able to function, the proposed new court?
Well, you know, let me be clear. I come from a place that is absolutely determined to do better by victims and witnesses. But I also come from a place that deeply recognises and respects and would seek to uphold the rights of the accused. And there's no doubt about it, people need representation. And, you know, absolutely any pilot would need solicitors to represent their clients. What I'm not going to do, bearing in mind we've still got a long way to go in terms of this bill, is I'm not going to turn the volume up on the debate.
I'm not seeking to inflame the debate. I'm just trying to assess what the government's position is in terms of confidence. You know, you've heard evidence yesterday from the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association and from others previously of a boycott. So just in terms of confidence about whether the proposed new court, which will be introduced at great cost and great effort, will be able to actually function.
So the proposed new court, Sexual Offences Court, is a separate establishment to the pilot. We will still have to make a decision about whether the pilot takes place in the Sexual Offences Court or whether it takes place in the High Court. And if time permits, I can talk to people about some thinking around that. I, of course, deeply regret that, you know, some criminal defence lawyers feel so strongly that at this point in time they're talking about a boycott. I think from my purpose, I will just continue to seek to engage as much as possible. I will seek to work with people on the detail. And I'm also, you know, again, briefly with respect, with Mr. Finlay, there's a parliamentary process going on here, which in my view should be respected. And there's a process here of inquiry and scrutiny. And, you know, and of course, you know, I'm not going to, you know, either box myself or anybody else into a corner.
No, I wouldn't expect it. I mean, in terms of my last question, I did slightly conflate the non-jury trial with the Sexual Offences Court. But in respect of the juryless rape trial pilot, will accused people be compelled to take part? Will they be given any right to object or
so? My view and the view of the government, and in terms of you know, the stakeholders on the notwithstanding various views on the working group, is that no accused and no victim decides which court they appear in, yeah, or which procedure they appear under. There may be, you know, in terms of, you know, the criteria, so when you set the criteria of the type of offence, so for example, if the criteria was focused on the single complainer, single accused, single act, you know, so-called acquaintance rape, it may be that someone might dispute whether their offence meets the category. There was certainly some discussion of that, but you know, people,
so the position nobody is, gets, yeah, the, so yeah, no accused and indeed no complainer can choose their court,
no,
whether that's a pilot or not. Yeah. Yet we heard from rape victims who, perhaps to some people's surprise, said they would have preferred and did prefer having a jury. So in that case, given the trauma-informed ethos of the entire legislation, would their views be taken into account?
So in terms of the pilot, there would be no option for the accused to choose whether they participate or not. That would be clearly defined in the criteria. And the question is, you know, does the crime that someone's accused of fit the criteria for that pilot? I think it was only in terms of victims and witnesses, I was just reflecting that across the piece right now, no one decides,
sure,
which court or which procedure. I did, and I think the point that you're touching upon is that invariably, you know, we can't, you know, pigeonhole or assume that victims and survivors are one homogenous group that have one homogenous view. I would never. I assume that. So I do understand that, you know, that there can be different views. But in terms of, you know, the work we've done in terms of the consultation around our proposals, in terms of our engagement with victims and witnesses and groups that represent them, and of course you've heard, you know, a lot of evidence yourself, so that there is. I would point to, while there's not unanimous support for this proposition, you know, there is good support for it.
Okay, so just to clarify, if I can very quickly.
Yeah, very quickly.
The accused in the bill as drafted cannot have any say in whether or not they take part in this pilot. Neither can the complainer, but that's open to some form of consideration. Is that a fair?
No, I just, no? I'm sorry, convener.
Decide.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
Well, I don't know, it's pertinent to the bill, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, so the point is, I'm reflecting that, you know, right now no one, you know, chooses their procedure or the court that they appear in. You know, that decision, you know, is taken elsewhere.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Pauline McNeill, followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you very much. So just want to examine how we would operate the single judge trial would operate. So you've had questions from the convener and Russell Finlay about how the pilot will be assessed. Will you publish what you're looking for here? Because there is some confusion. We've had three witnesses at least, including Professor James Chalmers, who seem to think that you're going to measure conviction rates. So, you know, it's not just the Scottish Criminal Bar Association that think that one of the assessment criteria will be conviction rates, which you've clearly said it won't be.
No.
But there's confusion around this. So will you publish?
There clearly is confusion. I mean, I think what I say to the convener is that the evaluation would include outcomes, which, of course, would an outcome of a trial. You know, you would... You know,
you would evaluate conviction rates.
Well,
then
you would record it. You would gather that information.
Ah.
Right?
Well, that's where the confusion is coming from.
So we gather that information. There would be information available, in depth around the written statements. But I think what I was refuting, Ms McNeill, mm-hmm. was the suggestion that the only thing that would be looked at in isolation was conviction rates.
Right, but so you will look at conviction rates as part. It will be a criteria.
It's one so of many criteria.
The witnesses
criterias.
Are quite correct then.
It's okay. One of many criteria, but it's not the only. It's not the only thing we're looking at.
Why would you include that when you've previously said... What was the purpose of including that?
Because you will want to look at the wide range of empirical evidence that is available. I mean, I suppose I'm thinking, why would you not?
Because it's confusing people, because you've previously said that you're not trying to alter the rate of conviction. What you're trying to do is change experiences and see if these experiences would be, as I had always understood it to be.
So you would have thought.
Yeah, but what, since we don't have any criteria, we've nothing, we have not been given. Am I correct in saying this, or could you republish it or something? But I don't know what the criteria for assessing the single judge pilot is.
So, there's 2 points to your question. So, in terms of what would be evaluated, in terms of the empirical information or evidence that is gathered, yes, that's about efficiency and effectiveness. Yes, it's about mm-hmm. experience, and yes, it's about what was the outcome of the trial. Is there more information, more detailed information that we can publish in and around that? The short answer would be yes, we can do that, and indeed, this was information that was worked on with the working group, and I'll check in a moment. In terms of what we have and have not published. We did publish a fact sheet in and around this, but I'll ask Heather to
What would be useful, Heather, actually, is to summarise that for the committee.
Well, the fact sheet did that.
Right, OK.
But if there's more detail, and I think I'm hearing that people want more detail to be made available, the proviso being that there is still no definitive...
We want to understand what the assessment process is.
Cabinet Secretary, respond.
But she's not answering my question.
I'm trying very hard to answer your question, okay. Ms McNeill, I assure you. We can share, whether it's new information or reshare information that's already been in the public domain, that's not a problem. The proviso, if that aids discussions and deliberations, the proviso is that there are still decisions to be made in and around, the criteria, time limited, is that a year or 2 years? Some of the, processes around evaluation. And while I have, emerging views around a lot of that, what should be in legislation, because I think there is more detail around the pilot that could be put in legislation. I mean, you'll forgive me that, I am keen also to, understand the committee's deliberation in the stage one report. So I can share more information now. I'm just highlighting that there are some decisions that are not absolutely made yet, right, because there's further engagement still, I hope, ongoing, with people who have, fundamental objections to the pilot. But I'm absolutely open to the fact if there is more need for more detail, perhaps on the face of the bill, as opposed to leaving all the detail to regulations, which was the original plan, that it would be anchored in the bill, but we would come back to Parliament, with more detailed regulations. But this won't happen without secondary legislation. But if there's more information that can be anchored in the bill and more information that we can make publicly, and we will, before the bill passes, before we get to either stage 2 or 3, have made more definitive decisions on the back of further consultation about the shape and size of this.
Would you like to come in? I think you were going to come in earlier on.
Just to build on what the Cabinet Secretary had said, so she mentioned that the working group had set out three broad objectives for evaluation, so looking at how the process of conducting single judge trials was perceived by everyone involved in the process, exploring the impact on effectiveness and efficiency, and considering the impact on outcomes. Now, outcomes doesn't just mean conviction rate, it also looks at things like early pleas and what point in the process that those might have happened. The working group was quite clear that they felt that first objective should have the most weight given to it, because actually it was their primary interest was in whether this improves complainants' experiences. So that was where they felt the focus should be. In terms of additional information, they did publish as an annex to their report quite a detailed list of questions that they suggested could be used in evaluating the pilot. And we can certainly make sure that the committee has a copy of that. So that goes through possible research questions and methodologies for each of those three strands of investigation. As the Cabinet Secretary has set out, there's obviously a balance between what is in legislation and what is not in legislation. And for a research project, so that the typical approach would be that wasn't encoded in legislation, but that as part of or alongside developing the regulations, that we would work with stakeholders on developing a specification for the research. But that list of questions hopefully gives a good indication of the kind of issues that could be explored as part of evaluation, how you might look at each of those three strands and what sort of questions you might use to try and evaluate the pilot.
Thank you very much. My next question is the Scottish Government confident when you decide to run the pilot and for how long and all that's been dealt with? Are you absolutely certain that an accused person who is convicted in a single judge under a pilot, which I don't think is a great word, I think it's been mentioned by other witnesses, because these are real cases, so it's not really a pilot as per se, but are you confident these cases won't be appealed on some human rights grounds that, say, the period was a year, so either side of that year, other people will be tried for the same crimes with a jury?
So, I am confident that a pilot is lawful. I am confident that as a government we will comply with ECHR. People have a right to a fair trial. They don't have a right to a jury trial. I know people are of a different view. And bearing in mind that single judge trials is not unique in our current system. Mm-hmm. In terms of appeals, you may have heard me talk about one of the strengths of a pilot is that written reasons are produced, and obviously under the current jury system, written reasons are not produced by a jury, and that option of juries writing their judgments was, dismissed by the Lady Dorrien review. And I know from some of my engagement with other jurisdictions and is that there's a real value in written decisions. It gives us not just an insight and understanding to what has led to conviction or acquittal, but there is a real transparency for both the complainer but also the accused. And actually, and I would argue that, actually the written reasons, potentially enhances the rights of the accused. So whether it, leads to, more appeals from the accused, well, that's not something I could predict, but I would point to the fact there's a real value in these written decisions. They take place elsewhere in other jurisdictions, and I think they are very valuable indeed.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Just lastly, trying to piece the different legal forms together, because they do connect quite a bit. So I take it then, Cabinet Secretary, it's possible then, if you set up a specialist court, the single judge would be sitting alone in a specialist court without a jury, with two verdicts?
So,
right.
Yes, right. So, we have still to make a decision as to whether the pilot, whether we call it that or not, whether that takes place in the Sexual Offences Court or the High Court.
Right.
So, let me run through the pros and cons of both. So, you could do, if you wanted the pilot to compare, actually, more about the current system, how it operates under the High Court, you know, you could do that comparatively quickly in the implementation process. But there are advantages to the pilot taking place in the Sexual Offences Court, because we're going to have to, given the wide nature of the reforms in the bill, that the sequencing of the reforms is very important. And it's important also to consider, you know, when the pilot's evaluated, we want it to be a clear evaluation of the added value or not of the pilot, as opposed to, you know, findings perhaps being more related to other reforms. So the phasing and the sequencing of the different reforms is particularly important. So again, no final decisions being made, but you could, for example, do the jury reforms and the abolition of not proven. You know, that could be the place to start. The introduction of lifelong anonymity is fairly straightforward. The Sexual Offences Court is a bigger undertaking. You probably want to phase that in with, you know, perhaps as the court recovery programme comes to an end, the establishment of a court would maybe take, you know, approximately, you know, 18 months. And then if you were having the pilot in the Sexual Offences Court, which there are advantages to, you know, you would then, you know, introduce the pilot at that point.
Just a supplementary, given what you said about a lot of change here and you want to compare and assess, would it not make sense to, if you were running the pilot, just to run it in the High Court where you already know how it operates? Whereas if you run the pilot in the specialist court you've just set up, which, you know, you hope you need to get that right, but would it not make sense for the pilot to be run in the High Court and you don't have to worry about the vagaries of a new system? That not make sense?
So there are pros and cons, and that's probably the shortest way of putting it. The other option, bearing in mind that, you know, there are many reforms. I suppose the advantage of doing it in the Sexual Offences Court gives us some other options in terms of the nature of the pilot. So if the pilot was to go and, you know, take place in the High Court, it would be a single judge pilot. If it took place in the Sexual Offences Court, we may have, you know, other options to look at a panel of decision makers. So that's what we're wrestling with.
Thank you.
Katie Clark, followed by John Swinney.
Thank you. My first question was going to be very similar to that asked by Polly McNeill, so I can maybe pick up where Pauline left off, because I was going to ask about how you evaluate a pilot with so little base data, and how that relates to the many massive changes that are being proposed in this bill. And as you know, one of the criticisms of the bill, it's a range of very big changes, potentially all at the same time. And I think you've outlined that some of those decisions have still got to be made in terms of whether a pilot would take place in the new courts, perhaps with some cases within the pilot, some outside the pilot, whether it would happen after the abolition of the not proven verdict and the changes in majority, and whether you would be comparing if you like, concurrent cases with each other as opposed to cases within the pilot to historic cases. And any data that we do have, and we understand there's very little data, but we do have some data, for example, around about conviction rates in terms of, you know, what's happened over recent decades. So I appreciate you've all got, you're still thinking through much of that. But don't you think it's right that Parliament knows which of those options are going to go forward? Don't you think those decisions need to be made during the course of this bill, and that Parliament needs to be very clear, given the significance of many of these changes, which proposal is going to go forward?
Yeah, actually, I do. Mm-hmm. I do. And it has always been my intention that as we progress, my intention, you know, has been, you know, post, you know, committee's deliberation, there is a bit of a, you know, chicken and egg scenario here. It's appropriate that I, you know, have canvassed a full range of views and insights. Yes, I think there are fundamental decisions in and around how the pilot will operate that will have to be made in the not too distant future, most certainly before stage three. But I would hope to be in a position, perhaps, you know, in advance of stage two, to at least be able to give more definitive detail on thinking and direction of travel as opposed to options.
So if the committee had views, then they would be taken into account. I'm not saying that you would necessarily agree with those views, but you would at least give them consideration.
Of course.
Yes,
of course.
Thank you. Based on her research, Professor Thomas told us that the jury conviction rates for rape cases in England and Wales ranged from 65% to 91%, depending on the age and the sex of the complainant, whether the offence was historical, and no doubt a range of other factors. Now, yesterday, the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association were saying very clearly that they didn't feel the many issues relating to rape cases were necessarily relating to juries. And I've got to say that juries haven't been one of the issues that's been raised with us by survivors in rape cases. The main issues they seem to raise, and I realise that there's not, you know, there's not one view, I appreciate that, in terms of different people have different experiences, but the main issues that rape victims repeatedly raise when they talk about the re-traumatisation of the process relate to how they're treated, delay in the system, which is a massive problem, and also, you know, partly relates to the floating diet issue, and also outcomes, you know, whether there's a conviction at the end of the day and indeed sentencing. Do you accept that juries don't seem to be a feature that survivors and victims and complainers have raised as a significant problem, and some of these other issues seem to be far more dominant in terms of the concerns that are repeatedly raised?
So in terms of conviction or acquittal or indeed a not proven verdict, juries are at the core of that. So, you know, you, like I, will have heard victims' testimony in and around, you know, conviction rates, yes, other matters. You will have heard views, very strong views, from victims and victims' organisations about not proven. And, you know, the role of juries, you know, are integral to that. So I suppose I wouldn't accept that juries aren't, you know, I wouldn't accept the narration that juries are removed from the picture. I accept, you know, that when it comes to, you know, responding to, you know, low conviction rates or the support and experience of victims, that has to be the whole system's approach. It is, of course, that end-to-end justice journey. I have never argued against that. There are, of course, changes, you know, that the police have made in terms of how they investigate. No one's suggesting that anybody's journey in this regard is over. We have, you know, specialism and prosecuting. Again, the journey is never over. I suppose my challenge has always been that what we have to avoid as parliamentarians, as part of the justice system, saying actually the problems don't rest with us, they rest elsewhere. And actually, you know, the problems exist throughout the system. In terms of what you said about conviction rates at the start of your question, I mean, I think to all of our great frustration, comparing conviction rates from one jurisdiction to another is deeply problematic. And, you know, data is recorded differently. Conviction rates are measured differently. And the point that I will end on is actually, and there's a really good, there's an excellent report actually done by the UK government 2021, and they did that end-to-end review of rape cases where they actually apologised to victims and witnesses for their experience. And one of the things that has a huge bearing on conviction rates is, of course, you know, the number of cases and the quality of cases that actually gets to court. And what we've seen in England and Wales is nearly a 60% drop in charges and prosecutions. And the debate south of the border, I don't know if you've seen a comment from some senior police chiefs south of the border, is that they are, and I'm not passing comment, I'm just narrating, is that they are, you know, saying that there's cherry picking goes on with prosecutors. So, you know, I'm pointing out the fact that, we need this whole system approach. But what we're focused on right now is this part of the system.
I understand. And I understand there's the different criteria to taking cases forward in England and Wales. And in Scotland, it's whether there's a sufficiency of evidence. But don't you think, given that we know that conviction rates are low in Scotland compared with other crimes, and notwithstanding what the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association were saying yesterday in relation to, for example, murder cases, the view is that rape conviction levels are too low. If you like, they are an outlier compared with other offences. You've said very clearly that abolition of the not proven verdict isn't to increase conviction levels. You are trying to, you know, fix the system so it doesn't have any impact in terms of conviction levels by changing jury size. Surely we should be looking for a system where there's a higher conviction rate in rape cases, given that there is sufficient evidence to convict. Those cases have been marked in the same way as any other case would be marked, on the basis that the Crown believes there's sufficient evidence to convict.
So I most certainly believe that we can't walk away and ignore conviction rates, and that you know, we need to have a system that has absolute that we can all have absolute confidence in, and that the comparatively low conviction rates for particular sexual offences, particularly in relation where the victim is a woman, should cause us all great concern and is a dent in the confidence that we can have in the system. As I said earlier, I mean, there's no quick button to press or lever. You know, nobody here wants to interfere with the independence of the courts and the decision makers. But we have legitimate grounds for inquiry. In relation to this pilot, there are other reforms in the bill that are highly germane to giving confidence to the system, to give confidence to victims and witnesses to come forward. But in relation to this pilot, we have very legitimate grounds for further inquiry. And that's what this pilot's about. It's not ignoring low conviction rates, recognising that it's complex, recognising that these are amongst the most sensitive and difficult cases in terms of their impact and outcomes and their devastating lifelong impact on primarily, but not exclusively, women. There is a fundamental question about access to justice here for women. So why would we not invest ourselves in further inquiry and that process when we have the case has been made for further inquiry.
So would you see success or a major factor of a success being higher conviction rates and rape? Success for the pilot, if it led to higher conviction rates, would you see that as being a successful outcome?
It's not the only outcome. And I'm sure I'm not alone here in wanting to improve access to justice for women and girls and victims of the most heinous offences that have lifelong consequences. We all share that.
OK, if I can maybe, well, the pilot, would lower convictions be, would that be seen as a failure?
So I've outlined...
I'm quite happy to have a yes or no answer. I'm trying to get a few... What do you see as success and failure?
It's not binary, mm-hmm. right? And I think it would be an understand why you're pressing me on this. It's not binary. Well, I want more women to have the justice that they deserve.
If it led to lower conviction rates, I would see that as a failure. So I just wonder if you would agree with me on that.
So... Well, we don't want to be turning the clock backwards. So, yeah, okay. I want to see, yeah.
Thank you.
More justice for more women.
Thank you.
Thank you. If I can swiftly bring in John Swinney, followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Convener. Just to go back to one of the points that Katie Clark was raising, Katie Clark referred to a number of issues that were raised with us during the course of our evidence taking by victims about the conduct of trials. And one of the points which Katie Clark didn't refer to, but which I certainly want to, was the conduct of the defence. And one of the interesting points of evidence that I thought we heard from Simon Dorolo was that in a situation where there was a judge only presiding and no jury, Mr. Dorolo believed that the tone and the atmosphere of the court becomes, let's say, less prone to theatrics and more a considered focus on the evidence. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary believes that that's an important consideration about trying to ensure that in addressing the experiences of complainants, that they are able to have confidence that the conduct of a trial will most definitely be trauma-informed in a judge-only pilot, but also that that perhaps provides more opportunity to consider dispassionately the evidence that is put in front of the court.
I very much agree with that, Mr. Swinney. In terms of the benefits of a more inquisitorial approach as opposed to an adversarial approach. As I alluded to earlier in this morning's, now this afternoon's proceedings, I have spent some time engaging with other jurisdictions. I'm not for a minute suggesting you can do a shift and lift from one jurisdiction to the other, but I do always think there is valuable learning and reflection from the experience elsewhere. And many comparable jurisdictions have a more inquisitorial as opposed to adversarial approach. And given that, these cases can be evidentially challenging, I think they need a particular approach. And what the pilot is trying to ascertain is, will change in the decision maker lead to better outcomes? Yes. Will more women get more justice? Will it be a fairer process for all involved, including the accused as well as the victims and witnesses? Will it be a better way of conducting affairs? Will it, use resources more effectively? I have to say I've always been persuaded that a more inquisitorial approach, particularly in these sensitive, complex, evidentially at times challenging cases, is most certainly worthy of consideration. I also have to recognise, and this has come through my engagement with criminal defence lawyers, that, you know, that's a big change for people. You know, if you've spent, you know, all of your career presenting evidence to persuade a jury, that that may well be quite difficult. Me, I've heard Simon Dirullo talk about it's, you know, perhaps a different skill set involved to, you know, persuading either a single judge or a panel of judges. And I, you know, acknowledge that, you know, change can be difficult, but I would stress that this is a pilot, that we need to have engaging minds on this, because we are feeling people collectively, we are feeling primarily women and girls. And I think we're all agreed we need to want to do better. We need to find a way, I, you know, would acknowledge, to bring as many people on board with the proposition of a pilot, and whatever we can do to provide more detail, to give clarity on key decisions at an earlier stage, I can give committee that absolute assurance.
And can, to what significance does the Cabinet Secretary attach to the provisions in section 65.5 of the bill, which specify the necessity for written reasons to be provided by a presiding judge in such circumstances? Because it strikes me that that provision provides some of the foundations for long-term developments in the approach to prosecution of sexual crime, because for everybody concerned, there will be a greater distillation of the analysis of the case and the evidence that will be able to be scrutinised as a consequence of the production of written reasons by a presiding judge in those circumstances.
I think there is a huge value in having written reasons. For the reasons that I outlined to Ms McNeill earlier, it will provide a quality of deliberative information that will be unparalleled. And I think the written reasons and the provision of written reasons, as well as, you know, transparency to victims and, you know, safeguarding, you know, the rights of the accused, will, is the reason why this pilot gives us an unrivalled opportunity to gather better evidence about what the real issues are and what the real deliberations are, what the challenges are. It will give us information that, you know, with the best will in the world, that we, you know, can't gather in any other fashion.
Thank you. Thank
you. Gregory, followed by Sharon Downey.
And apologies in advance, Cabinet Secretary, because the fullness of your answers already in this session, I do run the risk of asking you questions that might mean you're repeating yourself. But one of the things I wanted to ask is, you've talked a lot about, there's various opinions on the juryless trials throughout, but one of the places that we've seen a variety of opinions as well was within people who, victims who had experienced the court process. And I just wondered, when you're assessing the pilot, assuming that it goes ahead, what weight you'll give to sort of questions around that? Well, obviously, if people are doing the pilot, they won't have had experience of doing a jury, if you like, but will you try and make some comparisons between that to identify where victims and witnesses fail, you know, what one system was better than the other? And the reason why I ask that is because one of the victims in particular actually said that they would have rather a number of people were involved in their case as opposed to just one. So I'm wondering what how that will be filtered into the review of the pilot.
So a major part of the evaluation is looking at the experiences of everybody involved, whether that's the lawyers, whether it's the victims, whether it's accused. You know, I'm sure the, you know, judiciary will have reflections as well. And it's important that we are, you know, gathering the views and the experiences of everybody involved. And I think it's, you know, imperative that we do it in that rounded way. I hope that's answered your question.
Yes, no, I think so. I think it does. In terms of any pilot, I know you might not be able to answer this, but how close do you feel, or do the government feel, that a pilot is to actually beginning from when the bill is passed, as the bill is currently drafted. What is in the government's mind about that? Is there any dates or timeframes that you're considering?
So, as I said, I would hope to come back to committee and parliament with further clarity in terms of implementation, in terms of sequencing. In terms of right now, I mean, my preference on balance, again, not close to other representations, is for the pilot to take place within the context of the Sexual Offences Court. And that, in part, is because it may give us some further options to have a panel of decision makers as opposed to a single judge. And if I may, Convener, just briefly reflect on some of my European engagement. When I visited the Netherlands and I visited Germany, and in the not too distant future I'm going to go to Norway, and I stress that, you know, we can't do a shift and lift from other people's jurisdictions. But in the Lady Dorian review, one of the things that one of the reasons that they focused on a single judge pilot was that, one, it's not novel to our system, and the way our system works is quite hierarchical, you know, that there isn't an endless supply of judges. And when you visit other jurisdictions, they have you know, flatter systems, they will have many more judges. For example, when I went to the Netherlands, their judges are, and I hope my lords and ladies won't mind, you know, I met lots of quite younger judges. The diversity issue that they have in the Netherlands is that it's 75% women, but they have a bigger judicial resource because their structures are flatter. But when I was meeting with judges in the Netherlands, and yes, you know, they have single judge trials, but for the most serious cases, they have a panel of three judges. Now, that would be challenging in Scotland because we don't have an endless supply of judges. Other countries have mixed panels, judiciary and lay representation. But when I was engaging with the judges from the Netherlands, you know, they just spoke to the value of having peers and colleagues in terms of that process of deliberation and in terms of writing up written judgments. I mean, I am in favour and in support of a time-limited single-judge pilot, but I suppose if it was in the Sex Offences Court, where there are judges, temporary judges, sheriffs, principal sheriffs, it would perhaps, and I just say perhaps, give us an option to have a pilot that contained more than one decision maker. And that, you know, and hopefully I've not preempted, you know, some of my thinking, because our own conclusions, you know, have still to, you know, it's still to be completed. You know, with any proposition, you know, there can be, you know, things that you have to, you know, properly work through. And just to make clear that I am absolutely in favour of, you know, a single judge pilot, but there may be other options that we could explore.
And so given that there is more work to be done around the modelling of the pilot, which I think you've articulated well, and you know, all the various factors of the pilot, do you think then that there is an opportunity there, that there will be an opportunity upon passing of the bill, assuming that it is passed, for all the stakeholders, those who are supportive and those who have expressed concern, to come together to find a pilot that at least tries to meet some of these concerns? And do you think that there's anything that can be put in the face of the bill or through an amendment or whatever to, you know, to make that point so that it's maybe easing some of the concerns? Because this is one of the proposals that, you know, does seem to have a sort of 50-50 split, even in Lady Dorian's group. So it feels like it is something that could work and something that could be good, But even if that period between the bill's passing and the implementation of the pilot is seen as some sort of opportunity to bring people together, and actually the bill just now says that, and you and you know the defence, the other folk have raised concerns, get an opportunity to engage at that point. Is that something you've thought about or could be done?
I want to build as much consensus as possible. That is in the interest of our justice system. It is in the interest of victims, witnesses and the accused. And I think I've probably spoken on that point at length, convener.
Thanks. One further question, if that's OK. All right,
okay. Come back if you've got time.
No problem.
I think Sharon, would you like to come back?
Great, thank you. I maybe already know your answer to my question, given your previous comments. So at the moment, juries are now being directed by the judge on rape myths. And we've also got the Lord Advocate's recent reference. And we've not been able to assess the impact that that's had or the outcomes yet. We don't have any details on that. We're now proposing huge changes to the judiciary. So again, it's going to be a long time before we manage to assess the impact and outcomes and all those changes as well. So given that there's a lot of lack of clarity on the pilot, which again we've already said is not really a pilot because it's real lives, real cases, real outcomes, would we not be better to take this part of the bill out, take Section 6 out at the moment, wait until we've actually done a full assessment of all the other outcomes, of all the other things that we've implemented with the bill, and then bring it back with clear legislation rather than bringing it in through secondary legislation?
So we are and will bring forward clear legislation. Obviously, this bill is currently at stage one. It's still got stage two and stage three to commence. And I suppose I would dispute aspects of Ms Dowie's proposition. But what I'm not about is I'm not about copping out. You'll have heard the phrase, now's the time, now's the hour. We have decisions to make. And I don't think we should be kicking difficult decisions continuously down the line. There is evidence in and around the prevalence of rape myths in our society and how that impacts on juries. We've discussed at length lower conviction rates. We have discussed that there is a legitimate, entirely legitimate and pressing need for further examination. Why would we kick that further down the line? Whereas, yes, there's always work to be doing and working through the detail, but I'm not prepared to kick things down the line. We have an opportunity here and now to make seismic change on the bill as a whole. The pilot, yes, is one part of it, but the pilot says that we are not about to walk away from difficult issues. We're not prejudging the pilot, but we're prepared to invest the time, the work, the resource to tackle difficult issues that we are not anywhere near to resolving. So we should not be walking away from victims or difficult issues. We need to be focused on this. Now, that's what I'm focused on, government's focused on, and I think I'm quite sure committee's focused on what we need to do now.
I don't see it as kicking it down the line. I see it as making sure that you've got all the evidence there that you need to make the right decision and not putting in bad legislation. So we all want what's best for victims. We don't want any miscarriages of justice, but a lot of the evidence that we've already heard can be contradictory, depending on who's given us the evidence. We're hearing both sides of a story, so we don't want to put something in that is going to affect somebody's life. So this is real results that we're going to get. It's a real verdict. Somebody could be found guilty, not guilty, depending on a pilot, whereas some of the other things, like the jury one we done, it was mock trials, so we didn't do it in real life. So, and some of the evidence that we've been looking for on real trials, on the decisions of not proven, guilty, not guilty, we don't have any of that evidence. So rather than making a poor decision just now, where we don't seem to have
the backing of a lot of the judiciary, and even victims are saying that they're not in support of it. So it's just to make sure that we make the right decision. So this, why did the Scottish Government put it in, and it's not in the face of the bill, why they bring it in through secondary legislation? Because that kind of, to me, means that it's getting rushed to be included within this bill. It's a massive bill, which could have been broken down into smaller chunks.
And the issues that we are wrestling with, the here and now, have been around for at least 40 years. And if we don't, you know, grasp the difficult issues, we'll be kicking the can another 10, 20, 30, 40 years around. And I'm just not, that's not a position that I'm content with. Now, in terms of secondary legislation, I mean, it's not unusual for a detailed, you know, research proposition or something very specific to come at a later stage through regulation. Regulation often allows for further, more in-depth consultation and analysis. I think I've actually given, you know, I think I've been very transparent. I've probably perhaps been fairly overly transparent, some people may accuse me of later, on where my thinking is and the direction of travel in terms of doing more in terms of amendments and putting more information, particularly in and around the pilot, on the face of the bill. And, you know, in terms of research and evidence, we have overwhelming evidence that rape myths is a factor that influences decision making. Now, I know there's not unanimous views, but I would never expect there to be unanimous views amongst academics, in the same way I would never expect, you know, unanimous views either amongst the legal profession or indeed politicians. But this is, you know, what we as legislators are meant to be about. You know, we take it all in the round. And when we look at the evidence in the round, and I'm not going to cherry pick or play one piece of evidence off against another. We have vast and overwhelming evidence, you know, over much of it in the past 20 years, that rape myths can feature in jury trials. And again, we just shouldn't be ignoring that. There'll be more than one solution to this, but we have a duty to be exploring the benefits of all the tools that are available to us.
Okay, so if we're not going to pause to take into account the effect of all the other things that we've implemented, why have we not got all the details of the pilot on the face of the bill, and why is it coming in secondary legislation?
Well, I've answered that with respect in that it's not uncommon for there to be, you know, secondary legislation that flows from any piece of primary legislation. But I've already, you know, given a commitment in response to what I've heard, not just from this committee, but elsewhere, that people would like the reassurance of more detail on the face of the bill.
But would that not be seen as being rushed or trying to avoid scrutiny?
No, I don't think it's avoiding
I'd like
scrutiny.
To scrutinise the detail of what the pilot's going to be, but we don't have all that detail.
Well, and I have outlined lots of detail today with respect, notwithstanding that people, you know, are seeking further information. We have published a lot of information also, I may add. But I will always endeavour to be as transparent and timious around conveying the decisions that we have to make and will make.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we've had a long session already, so I'm going to move on to the other parts of Part 6. Which relate to lifelong anonymity for survivors and independent legal representation. And I'm just going to ask any member who would like to come in on either of those Katie Clark.
Yes, and I have spoken to the Cabinet Secretary previously about independent legal representation beyond that proposed in this piece of legislation. And I just wondered, given that she had been to Norway and various other jurisdictions where they do have more extensive rights of advice and representation for victims, whether she had any reflections on that.
So I've not been to Norway as yet. I've been to the Netherlands. And I have been to Germany, where I had the opportunity in Berlin to meet victims' lawyers, amongst other representatives of the judicial system. And that, of course, is very informative. In terms of the what's currently proposed in terms of independent legal representation, and that being centred around the Section 275 process, I am committed to that being implemented in a way that is a foundation for future potential change. So my focus, bearing in mind committee's quite correct focus on deliverability and implementation, is first and foremost on what is proposed in the bill. But I am conscious that Ms Clark and actual other MSPs are actively engaged on this issue.
The convener is aware that we had a lawyer from Norway who was over in the Parliament last year, and she'd previously been a defence agent but is now employed full-time as a representative of victims. And over the last 50 years, that system has developed in Norway. Is it possible, obviously, depending on the rest of her commitments, if the Cabinet Secretary could maybe look at that when she's in Norway and look at their system to see if there's anything that can be learnt?
I would love to do that. I'd love to do that.
OK, thank you. Russell Finlay.
Just on independent legal representation for rape victims, everybody seems supportive of this in principle, but there's some very detailed and specific concerns about how it will work in practice. The Crown Office submitted 4 pages of concerns. The courts and the Law Society and the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association have all raised concerns. It's more about the practicality that this is going to inevitably lead to more delays in the system, which will be contrary to complainers and their well-being and interests. Now, Lady Dorian has also said in her evidence to us that the bill as drafted needs to be streamlined in this respect. So I'm just keen to know what exactly, in response to all of this concern, the Scottish Government is practically doing to address this.
So there's 2 issues. I note that Lady Dorian also said that if people stuck to the timescales, there shouldn't be any undue impact associated with delays. She did, however, and I would notice this comments shared by other people, have commentary around the disclosure process. And just to confirm, it is an area that we are looking to simplify via amendments. The process as envisaged would have the Crown Office applying to the court to release information to the victim's representative, and I think that process could be more efficient and abbreviated. There was some suggestion that, actually bearing in mind that the scope of the 275 application that is very clear about the evidence to be shared, that actually you wouldn't need the Crown Office to go to court.
Yeah. But during a trial, a 275 can be applied for, and I think that was one of the other concerns, that this would potentially cause a trial to halt while this needed to be addressed. Is that something specifically that's been looked at?
So it has been looked at, and again, the timescales are very specific. In terms of the current system, there are various processes and actions that have to take place, no less than 7 days, no less than 14 days. And in terms of enabling, and I think we all recognise that the complainer, would need time to, appoint representation, etc., that, some of those processes would go to no less than 21 days. And yeah, that there's an overarching time frame. Some others, like Ms Clark, will be probably more in and about the detail from a practice point of view, but there are some overarching processes that have to happen within 28 days in the context of a trial.
And all of that makes sense when it's a preliminary hearing, when it's in advance of a trial, but I think there's still an issue about during proceedings. We still don't really know how that will be addressed. It's even if you, whatever the time scale, if the application during a trial is made, the complainer then will have to seek legal representation and then we'll have to go through this process. And that's going to, by its nature, cause the trial to stop at that point while this needs to happen.
So I think there are some aspects of this that are about court processes, and I've indicated that we will bring forward some amendments in and around that, but there are other aspects around ensuring that there are people and resources available for people to access that independent legal representation. And I just wonder, Jeff, is there anything you would like to add to Mr Finlay's question?
Yeah, I think, first of all, the provisions as drafted on the bill were developed with those stakeholders, so that they're not, I think they are emerging concerns as we've walked through the process. So some of the issues that you raised, quite rightly, we've looked to reflect. Key focus was always in terms of how you manage a new intervention in the criminal justice process and the impact that would have on timescales, recognising the person-centred trauma-informed approach. So we've been very much looking at that. So there will be a number of iterations of the operational process as we walk them through with operational partners, particularly the one about disclosure. Initially, the view was that that was best placed with the led by the Crown Office. In retrospect, we now think that probably rests with the independent legal representative. But again, you need to measure the impact that would have there on the role of the ILR.
And presumably that work will also include assessing what weight or what effect the
intervention
will be of the ILR. If they're just there to sit beside a complainer and have no meaningful input,
the key part
other than to advise them, but whether the court has to take heed of anything they say or whether the judge has to then assess that, we don't really know that, do we?
The key importance is obviously enabling sufficient time for the ILR to undertake their role, and that's the key for us as you work through the time frame.
Right. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much. I totally agree with you, Cabinet Secretary, about the need for change. 100% I'm with the government, and that's what it's trying to achieve. But in relation to some of the things that survivors and complainers have said would make a difference, so we've heard the issue of independent legal representation and the difference that might make to complainers who felt that their voice is not heard at the preliminary stages, no one to defend their interests. So I do welcome that. But further to that, a lot has been said in the evidence and the roundtables that we've had with the notion of a single point of contact. And in fact, in my own mind, I think changing practice is probably more important than changing in the law, or as important. So we've heard positive stories, actually. I've heard a lot of really horrific stories, but positive stories. And those seem to turn on those complainers getting proper access to their advocate depute, understanding how the trial will be run. Now, I realise there's only so far you can go with this, but a lot of victims will say, I didn't get to tell my story in court. I didn't understand why the advocate deputy didn't ask me what I thought was a critical question. And I'm sure there are good reasons for that. So I just wondered if it's something that you're willing to explore within the arena of changing the experience for all complainers and victims about how we can ensure that every victim gets access to their advocate deputy before the trial. The single point of contact has a lot to do with, you know, changes to court venues, things, the practical things. Where is my case? When is it going to be heard? And it struck me, which is why I think there's a relationship with independent legal practitioner, is that perhaps someone who is legally qualified is also the best person to be that single point of contact because they know the court process.
So it's absolutely imperative for anyone who has went through the trauma of a sexual offence that as they proceed through the criminal justice system, where there will be decisions that are not in their gift, that there will be decisions in terms of you know, what court it goes to, what process is applied that is, you know, out with their control. But nonetheless, you know, there are matters where we have to be open to choice. And, you know, you'll have heard just one example, you'll have heard, you know, many examples supporting that move towards pre-recorded evidence. But some people, some victims may want to have their day in court, and that sense of control and choice is absolutely imperative to recovery. Your point about single point of contact, I think, is well made. And I'm also cognisant of the difference between independent legal advice and independent legal representation. But I'll check, Jeff, is there anything you want to add that would be useful to Ms McNeill?
I think I'd probably reflect back to the original consultation document, which was informing the development of the provisions around ILR, and a lot of that commentary was around many of the respondents' greater improved communication, mm-hmm. Awareness and engagement, which are very distinct from the concept of ILR as envisaged by Lady Dorian. Yeah. So that's very much an area that we feel is something we can explore with the Emma Rich Law Clinic and others as we move in parallel with the work around how we deliver the ILR model and also the evidence base for whether you extend ILR beyond that. So I think there's still a bit of work, I think, to do with lived experience to actually be very clear about the expectations. But very much it was around feeling part of the process as opposed to introducing something new. More about perhaps some of the existing services, improving some of that service delivery potentially.
Yeah, no, that's helpful.
And I also didn't, you know, it was remiss of me not to mention the work of the Victims Task Force that is very much focused on the quality and nature of communication, you know, whether that's verbal or written.
Just finally, I mean, prior to this work, I mean, I'm dealt with a lot of families who felt similarly in murder trials, for example, the same feeling of exclusion. So it's not just particular to rape trials. But we've heard a Lord Advocate say that she is very, very particular about changing this practice. I think there's a drive behind it. That's what I see. So this is good, but Lord Advocates change in time, so another Lord Advocate might take a stricter view about access to EDs and so on. Can I just leave you with this thought, that could you consider, is there any way in which you could enshrine that right in some way? I don't need an answer just now. It worries me that we're beginning to see chinks of light, which are really good, but we need to make sure it continues. And the law is a tool. But anyway, I just wondered if you would consider how we could hang on to that.
It's embedding the best of practice. Of course, there always needs to be flexibility for individual circumstances, and we'll take away Ms McNeill's thoughts on the matter. Thank you.
I wonder if I can just come in with a final question, and it's actually on the proposals around anonymity for victims. So the written and oral evidence that we've received indicates significant support for victims of sexual offences having a statutory protection of their anonymity. However, there were some issues raised within that, and one was in particular whether protection of anonymity should extend beyond the death of a victim, coupled with a right for family members to waive that. So just wondered if the Cabinet Secretary can respond to that.
So this is another area of great complexity and sensitivity. On the one hand, we do not want victims to feel that they are forced into anonymity. Again, it's that point about choice and control. I'm also conscious for loved ones left behind that there can continue to be some traumatic and ongoing intrusion. So this is a very complex and difficult issue. The starting point of this is that the rights to privacy in GDPR expire upon death, and you know this isn't about a wee tweak in a bit of legislation or a change of one bit of legislation, but we have started a process through the representation that I've had and others from victims' organisations on this matter, and I've also discussed it with Dr. Tickell, who I know you've heard. So we're looking at the experience in other jurisdictions. It is an area that we need to proceed with great care, because we do not want to be criminalising families who want to speak, who want to give testimony to the loved one they've lost, who may want to be critical of the justice system, the court process, or the sentence. And you know, there's a lot of lessons to be learned from other jurisdictions, Victoria and Australia and Ireland, where they've went down one course to legislate in terms of anonymity continuing beyond death, and then they've had to, on the back of further representations from victims, they've had to revisit all of that. And the, you know, so you'll have seen you know, the correspondence that Dr. Tickell has written to committee. I've seen that. I have also a week or so ago wrote to this committee and also the Children and Education Committee, because there's the Children Care and Justice Bill just now as well. So in terms of finding a way forward, there's a few things that I've committed to. And the first thing is I'm not going to make false promises in this, because there is no way I am going to make false promises to victims and then have to do a big retreat. I won't do that. I just won't. But I can commit to genuinely engaging with the issue and the knowledge that, that it just isn't easy. We are going to have a round table, I think, on the 20th of February. And I think, well, I don't think I know that invitations have went to some members of this committee who are spokespeople for the party. And that will have a wide range of stakeholders from, you know, people who may have a view in this from a press perspective, legal experts, Dr. Tickell has been invited, and victims organisations as well. I have also had my own engagement with people who have been affected with the greatest of intrusion, and will do a further engagement focused on families, and essentially, you know, to explore with them their views about how we, you know, could potentially, you know, overcome some of the difficulties. For example, you may get different parents who have a different view on anonymity, whether that should be waived or not. So that's a real life issue in today's world. There are a whole host of other complexities, but what I want to achieve with absolutely no false promises is that, you know, we want to be able to empower those who want to speak while protecting the privacy of those that are left behind.
Okay, thank you for that very comprehensive response. So we're going to bring, you'll be glad to know, the session to a close. Thank you for your forbearance. Just before you do leave, I might incur the wrath of members, but I just really wanted to ask if there's anything further that you want to add by way of any final comments, either on the parts that we've looked at today or indeed parts 1 to 3.
No, other than I look forward to committee's Stage 1 report and the debate in due course. I have no doubt that the committee will provide further food for thought on how we can achieve the very best of legislation, both for victims now and the here and now, but also in the future.
Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you indeed also to officials for attending today. That concludes the public part of this meeting, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.